we got the hot mic rocking and rolling. Good evening.
Thanks for coming.
Okay. All right. So tonight again, thank you guys for coming out. I appreciate it. Eat up. We got plenty of pizza. Although whatever we don't have in shore, we can make do. We can figure something out. With it. We need to get soda tonight, so I apologize about that. But so we're gonna hit big idea number five. It's this entire board, and then actually there's a little bit more, believe it or not, to talk about like entropy and then the idea of Gibbs free energy. So I'm gonna try and rip through this. You might notice that I kind of left it a little bit more fill in the blank again for like speed purposes. If I'm going a little too fast, just throw a hand up, ask me to kind of re-explain it and rock and roll from there. All right, but big idea number five actually kind of takes and puts two units together, talks about just like the idea of thermochemistry in general. So the idea of like changes in matter and heat and putting energy into break bonds and energy of form bonds. And that's why we kind of close out the board over there with the heating curve, cooling curve, and the phase diagram. So jumping right in it, starting right off the get-go. What do we know, guys? Heat is always transferred from what to what? It's always given from the what object to the what object. Always from the...
Particle.
Very nice. So you should say high energy object to the low energy object. All right, we want to use correct terms here, right? Again, we want to try and Jedi mind trick these people into it. I was actually talking to one of my buddies. He grades, last night I was talking to him, he actually grades for AP Gov, and they grade for 7 days straight. They get there on a Sunday, they grade from Monday to the following Sunday, and then they go home. So again, think about the fact you might have somebody who's on day six or seven of grading open-ended. Let's prove it to them. So to wrap our brains around it, yeah, it's high to low energy, but what could you also think of that as? Like more conceptual, more like legitimate, or more, just easier to understand. Maybe the
hot to
cold, right? So just remember that it's always the hot to cold, the high energy object's always giving its energy to the low energy object. That's why when we touch things, we feel different sensations. We feel hot or we feel cold, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. What do we know about the quantity of energy? What do we know? And this kind of blends us beautifully right into the first law of thermodynamics. What do we know about the quantity of energy that is given from the high energy object to the low energy object or from the hot to the cold? The quantity of energy is always what? Is always
equal.
Nice. Is always equal. All right. The quantity of energy given from that high to that low is always equal, right? But what is different? So the quantity, the actual value is equal, but what is different? The
temperature between the two?
The temperature could be because of specific heat and stuff. But what I'm just talking about, just like the value of Q. The actual numerical value is the same, but what is the opposite? What is
the system that's around?
The sign.
Yeah.
Right? The sign of the value is opposite, right? Is opposite. So if something is exothermic from the system's perspective, the surroundings is saying what?
Same but negative.
Same but negative, right? So what we're just kind of getting at here is Q of the surroundings equals negative Q of that of the system. If the surroundings is going to absorb 100 joules of energy, where did that 100 joules of energy come from? Well, if I'm absorbing that 100 joules of energy, I must be getting the negative of that from the system or from the surroundings, whatever perspective we want to talk about it. So it's always going to be the same value, but different or opposite sign. All right. So just remember and think about what data do they give you? What data are they asking you for? And all that kind of good stuff and all that kind of fun stuff. All right. With that, I gave you kind of like the overall Q being the same. And actually, yes, very good. We're going to add that in there, right? So because of the fact that we have this thing called the heat capacity, delta T will be different. And we're going to kind of start the board and end the board talking about Q and talking about Q of the system and whatnot. So just keep in mind that, and this is like that multiple choice question that always gets everyone every year. If I take a hot piece of metal and put it into water, the metal drops like 50, 60 degrees. The water only goes up 5. Who gained, who lost more energy? The water dropped 60 degrees and the water only went up 2. Who gained or lost more energy? Did the water gain more energy than the metal lost, or the metal lost more energy than the water gained, or vice versa, or what's the answer?
Trick question.
It's a trick question. They are equal, and that's what's so hard. It's like it doesn't make any goddamn sense. You went down 60 degrees, you only went up 2. Energy must be different. No. That's the whole point. We're starting and ending this entire board with Q. You'll see it when we come back to it, right? See it when we come back to it. So that kind of, again, as I was hinting at, this leads us to the first law of thermodynamics. What's the first law of thermodynamics? That energy
cannot be created nor destroyed.
Nice. Created Energy cannot be created, nor can it be destroyed. And so if I have a certain amount of energy and that goes in, it has to be completely absorbed. And again, this is what kind of allowed for us to only realize that we have to transfer energy. It's kind of the idea of the renewable energy resources that we're looking into as a species at this point in our history of this thing being called living on Earth. And what that really set us up for was similar to Q of the surroundings is Q of the system. When we start to actually talk about enthalpy, when we start to actually talk about the energy of formation or the energy of bonds, we know just like Q of the system equals Q but negative of that of the surroundings, delta H of the system equals
the negative delta H of the
surroundings, right? So vice versa, it does not matter. The quantity is always the same. I lose 100 joules of energy, that 100 joules of energy has to go somewhere, right? That 100 joules of energy has to go somewhere. Okay, with that, second law of thermodynamics, this had to do with entropy, right? So the first one was our enthalpy. The second one is entropy. And what did we say about the universe? Is the universe always going towards order, or is the universe always going towards disorder or randomness?
Disorder or randomness.
Very nice, right? The universe is always expanding. It's always moving towards disorder. It's always moving towards randomness, right? We always want to become more disordered. We always want to become more random. And so when we get into that idea of spontaneity, we actually want delta S to always be positive. So if you were to actually take the delta S of the system and the delta S of the surroundings, overall, that's going to be positive. So what's very interesting about entropy is, do we say anything about that it has to be the same for entropy? No, it's not really going to be the same because the universe is always expanding. So we do have an actual change. So that's why the second law isn't that like whatever order you gain is disorder lost or vice versa. There is no equal there, all right? Moving on, standard state conditions. So we talk about this for enthalpy. We talked about this for a crazy little thing called like electrochem, all that other fun stuff, right? What do we know? What's the standard? What's the standard that we have going on for our ATMs? We talked about this a little bit during gas pressures and during that unit. What's the standard ATM?
1.0,
right? Or 1.00, depending on... Check this on the reference sheet, right? Another reference sheet alert. This is another thing that the reference sheet provides for you. You don't have to memorize it, but just be comfortable with it. Be aware of it, right? Again, you don't have to have it memorized. Anybody remember?
760.
Oh, nice. 760. Again, you don't have to memorize it. It's on the reference sheet. But the more comfortable you are with it, the easier and easier it's going to make your time in your life. What's standard temperature? My brain. This is my issue. This is my problem. I always have to kind of take a breath. What's standard temperature? Standard temperature is actually 0.0 degrees Celsius, right? I always think 25. For some reason, my brain is always wanting to say 25 degrees Celsius. Anybody remember what 25 degrees Celsius is? Because apparently it's not standard temperature. What is 25?
It's room
298 Kelvins, but what is it universally accepted as?
Room temperature.
Room temp, right? So if they ever talk to you about room temp, or that's what we're normally under, is that 25 degrees Celsius, okay? So my brain, for some reason, I'm special on a lot of levels, but for some reason, anytime I hear standard, I always want to think standard temperature. When they talk to me, for some reason, 25 is jumping in my brain. That's not standard temperature, that's room temp. The 0 degrees is the standard temp, okay? What would that be in terms of Kelvin?
273.
273. This is another one I really want you to take a look at. It's kind of like Faraday's constant. Some years Faraday's constant is 96.5 on the answer sheet or the reference sheet. Some years it's 273 Kelvin. Other years it's what it really is, 273.15. Just like Avogadro's number. Some years it's 6.02. Sometimes it's what it really is, 6.023. times 10 to the 23rd. So just take a look at it, all right? Just take a look, and just when you get that thing, that should be one of the first things we get our hands on and we get rocking and rolling. How about for standard concentration of solutions? Like especially when we talk about electrolytic cells, it's always what concentration? 1.0, 1.00 is usually a little bit better. All right, so just remember 1 molar. And again, it's kind of hard to wrap your brain around it, but the way that I remembered that 1 molar is pretty damn concentrated, think of 1 million dollars, right? Would you like $1 million?
Yeah.
Hell yeah, dude. To me, in my opinion, that's life-changing money. That's life-changing money. I know I'm very frugal and everything, but so when I see something like 0.5 molar, I might look at that at first and I might say 0.5 molar, that's not really a lot, but would you want $500,000?
Yeah.
Is that a lot of money?
Yeah.
Heck yeah, dude. So even 0.5 is still pretty large, right? But the standard is that 1.00 molar, and that's the standard concentration. Delta HF for a pure substance. Remember, they might give you these delta HFs, and we might have to add them all up. Anybody remember what pure substances are? We usually don't give them to you. They're usually not on these data tables because...
Zero.
Woo-hoo-hoo! Nice. Yes, they are usually zero. All right, the enthalpy is usually zero. So with that, if you guys didn't bring rabbit food, there's tons of pizza. There's tons. You didn't bring your rabbit food. But it would be zero, and that's kilojoules or joules. And again, that's going to be per mole, okay? So it is going to be zero, and just keep that in mind. They usually would give it to you, but you might not see that. So my afternoon squad, right, we kind of got into this a little bit today. We looked at one of the practice problems that had to do with delta H coming from, remember, there are three different ways to calculate delta H. This is one way, this is the second way, and in the video, I don't think you can see that, but there's a third way on the top, which is what's called Hess's law, okay? But we're here, we're live in the living color. So with that, the one way that you might have to calculate this heat of formation, this delta HF thing, is you might have to take Q, which again, we kind of started off talking about, we're gonna end with calorimetry. But we're gonna take that of, remember, the Q has to be the Q of the system. And I'm gonna reiterate back when we get to the end of the board, but usually when you do calorimetry, you're not getting the system, you're usually actually getting the surroundings first, and then what do I have to do to the system? What do I have to do to the Q value to be able to plug it in there? Don't forget to take the negative of it, right? Flip the sign of it, okay? Because again, calorimetry, we're always measuring the surroundings, but delta H, that is gonna be of the system, and it's always gonna be a mole, and it's because it's always joule or kilojoule per mole, and that's the mole of what actually reacted. So it depends on what they're talking about. If they're talking about something dissolving in, that's the moles that you dissolve. They're talking about two things reacting, that's the moles of the limiting reactant that reacted. So this might be an LR, this might be how much you actually dissolved, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, okay? Now to be able to read the calorimetry problem and be able to take it down. So what is enthalpy in a nutshell? What would you say? What's the definition of enthalpy? It's
the energy
needed what?
To use up the reactant because it's the mole.
Okay. How much energy needed to use up?
Yeah.
How much energy is released or used up and absorbed? Now remember, we kind of discussed this the other day. Whether it's endothermic or exothermic, what do I always have to overcome first? The activation energy. So remember, enthalpy could be and usually is a different thing than the actual activation energy. So it's how much energy is released or absorbed as the reactants completely separate, they're used up, and the products are formed. It's your investment, it's your return in the stock market. You put X amount of dollars in, when you cashed out, how much energy was the difference between what you put in to break all those bonds and to separate all those reactants, and then how much money did you take out when it was all said and done? Did you put $500,000 into the stock market and you only took out $250,000? Well, you just paid, that was endothermic, you just gave up $250,000, right? You just gave up $250,000. If I have a delta HF, if I do one of these three calculations from calorimetry, from the summation-based math, or Hess's law, and if I get a value that is negative, what does that tell me about the forward direction of the reaction? If I get a delta HF that's negative, that tells me that the forward reaction is, nice, is exo. It's losing energy. Bless you. It is losing energy. As far as spontaneity, now remember, you can't use the word spontaneous anymore. You have to use thermodynamically favorable. But as far as something happening on its own, once it overcomes activation energy, will it happen on its own? AKA spontaneous, AKA thermodynamically favorable. Are negative delta H is what we want? Are those spontaneous? Are those what we call thermodynamically favorable?
Yes.
Yes, they are, right? They are thermodynamically favorable, right? Okay, as far as delta H is considered for the reaction, for the system itself, the system always wants to release energy. You always want to cash me outside, how about that? You always want to put money into the stock market and take more money out. You want to take that money out of the stock market, right? We being the surroundings,
this stock market being the system. I don't want the stock market taking my money. I want the stock market giving me some money, right? So delta H's, if they are positive, though, what about if it is a positive? If it's positive, now the forward is
endothermic.
Is now endo, right? Forward reaction is now endo. And is that what we consider thermodynamically favorable?
No.
No, that is not thermo favorable, right? Not thermo favorable. Also realize, I'm not squeezing it in there, but if the forward is exo, what does that tell you about the reverse?
Endo.
Endo, right? If the forward is endo, that tells me the reverse is
exo.
Exo, right? So with that, number two, the way that they might actually do it, because people usually have already done all the work for us. They took the calorimeter, they did it, they divided it by the moles of the reactant. They did all this nonsense. They did all this math that we're going to look at over there in a couple minutes. They did all that for us. So if I actually know my delta HFs, if you actually provide me a list of delta HFs, which you will see, what is the lower, the case F, what is the little subscript of F stand for? It stands for
formation.
So you will see, they will say heat of formation and put it in a data table. As soon as I start to see that, notice, and when you go take a look at your reference sheet, the F is not there for the calorimetry thing, but the F will be here. And when you go look this up, again, you don't have to memorize this. This is on the reference sheet. But it's what? It's always the what minus what? It's always the summation of the
products.
Beautiful. Products. So the N, what does N stand for again?
Moles.
Number of moles. And unlike voltage, I do multiply by moles because remember, delta H is usually kilojoule per mole. So how many moles times its enthalpy? So it's the moles of products times the enthalpy of the products minus the
reactants.
Moles of the reactants times its enthalpy. Booya Kasha, give me my points. And again, they will always give that to you. Okay. They will always give that to you. And we're looking at kilojoules per mole. All right. Well, what about bonds? Yo, what about if they start talking to me about bonds? What if they start talking to me about like delta H sub B or delta H of bonds, where they use these words, bond enthalpy or bond energy? What if they start hitting me with bonds? Well, what did we say?
Bonds
be backwards. Right. Bonds be backwards. Yo, bonds be backwards. And what do I mean by that? Well, what I mean by that is when we do that delta H math, if we're talking about bond energies, if we're talking about bond enthalpies, not heats of formation, but rather bond enthalpies, now delta H is going to be the summation. Oh, what the heck was that? Ew. Oh my God. There's a sigma. Now it's not products minus reactants. Now it's
reactants minus products.
Beautiful. Reactant times the delta H of reactant minus the summation. Let's see if we can do it twice in a row. The N of the products times the delta H of the products, right? So again, those are not going to say delta HF. It'll say bond energy. It'll say bond enthalpy. It won't say delta HF. So then it's just delta HB. Bonds be backwards, right? We're not now, and when we're talking about that, we're not talking about a reaction. We're talking about one specific compound, and we're looking at the bonds inside. In order to break bad, in order to break bonds, what do you got to do with energy? Do you always put energy in to break bonds, or do you always get energy out to break bonds?
Yeah.
Very nice. It's always endothermic. Energy always has to go in to break bonds, right? And we would call that endothermic. I always have to put energy in order to actually separate those things from each other, all right, to actually separate that bond, whether it's ionic, whether it's polar covalent, non-polar covalent. And then what happens when we form bonds? Energy is released, right? Energy is released. Energy comes out, and we call that exothermic. Energy is always released when you're actually forming bonds. That's why, again, go back to your energy curves. Every single energy curve that you ever look at, whether it's endo or exo, it always goes here and goes up. That energy is what we call the activation energy, whether it's exothermic or whether it's endothermic. I always have to put energy in to get up to the activated complex. And then after the activated complex, whether it's exothermic or endothermic, what always happens to the curve? Once I get to the activated complex, the curve always does what? Always
goes down.
Does it go down enough to overtake it? Well, that's endo-exo. But regardless, always energy in, activation energy to break bonds. Energy out when we make bonds or release bonds, release for bonds. How are you feeling about that? Beginning of a little bit of thermal for you or on you. All right, let's see what we got getting up with getting down here. Let's just readjust real quick. Now I'm going to work with my sponsor. Do you guys notice the shirt I'm wearing for you tonight?
Relax.
Chandler, you're in a Snoop, babe. Chandler, you're in a Snoop on Thursday. Just
Yeah, I can't.
I've been slept in like 3 days.
Come on.
I won't do that. That's not relax. Don't do it. Okay, let's not go there, right? Let's not start going there. All right, so here we go. So, okay, well, what if I don't have calorimetry? What if somebody didn't do the HEDO formation before? What if we're talking in complete hysteria or just talking about these things called reaction mechanisms? What if, again, I challenge you to just get from here to the Freeland Raceway Mall? I don't know. I don't care. I don't want to know how you got there, just so long as you get from here to there, right? Maybe we even talk up to you about rate determining steps. Well, as you are brought in as a chemical engineer, right, we are looking at the fact that, well, I might not know exactly what's going on in this reaction, but if I do know the delta HX, if somebody did all this summation-based math, so look at the beauty of how thermodynamics of enthalpy actually works. We start by talking about just one species reacting. Then we actually start to apply it to, like, reactions. So now it's not just how much energy is one species have or is it cost to create one. Now we start to look at what happens when the reaction occurs, and now we're going to take it a step further with Hess's law, and we're going to look what happens when we start mashing reactions. It's like the Russian doll thing. Just it's a doll within a doll within a doll, right? So what's awesome about Hess's law is that it's going to allow us to calculate delta H for a reaction. It's going to allow us to calculate delta H for a reaction by adding up. Remember, we are going to sum up by adding up the delta HF. Delta HF for elementary steps, right? That's what these things are called. This is what's called a rate mechanism. Well, kind of like a rate mechanism. We have to manipulate it. It's almost a rate mechanism. And remember, these individual steps in the rate mechanism are what we call the elementary Dear-Watson steps. So, very stereotypical question. They give you a reaction like this, ammonia reacting with oxygen to produce nitrogen monoxide. Nitrogen monoxide, and then our water. They want to know what the delta H is. They want to know what the delta H for this reaction. We're not doing it in a calorimeter. We don't have the exact individual elements. We don't know how much each of these elements or each of these compounds needed in order to be created. All we do know are that we have these reaction mechanisms. So what do we think we're doing? Anybody remember what we do? Anybody remember what to like start looking at and matching up and all that fun stuff? What am I doing in the first reaction? What am I doing in the first reaction in my elementary step? What do you suggest, Ryan? What do you got?
We want to keep it the same but double it.
Keep it the same but double it. Perfect. How'd you know to do that?
Because the NO needs to be 4.
Boom. So this would be my mental anchor. That would be my mental anchor, ladies and gentlemen. I'm looking at maybe the oxygen. I'm getting maybe a little squirrely. I'm getting maybe a little excited about the oxygen. I'm like, ooh, baby, I like me some oxygen. But in looking through the other reactions, remember, if just like when you're balancing, if you find an element or if you find a compound in more than one situation, leave it to the end. So I love what Brian said there. We're going to use the nitrogen monoxide as our mental anchor. I want to keep it as is, but I want to multiply this entire thing by 2 because that's my mental anchor. Yeah, but Mom, that only gives you 2 oxygens and you need 5. Ignore it to the end. Worry about your mental anchor. So as I suggest, I would just rewrite this thing. I'm going to leave it as is, but multiply by 2. So it's now 2 moles of nitrogen gas reacting with 2 moles of oxygen. That's not 5. It'll work out. Times or yields 4 NOs. Now, Tuesday for voltage, we would multiply like that, but we didn't multiply the voltage. So I don't multiply the enthalpy, right?
No, right?
What's the unit on the bottom? Unit on the bottom is that mole, baby. So I'm going to multiply it by 2. We don't have a calculator available to us, but we don't need no stinking calculator. It's going to be that positive, I believe, although I shouldn't act so tough, right? I think it's positive 361.2, okay? What am I going to do with the second one? Anybody think they have an idea, or can anybody pick something out or have a mental anchor about what to do with the second one? All right, Max, we got salute. Flip it, Rex. Why do you want to flip a source Rex? So good. So I definitely absolutely want Philadelphia. You want to do anything else to it, though? Oh, yeah, baby. Not only do I want to flip a source Rex, but I also want to multiply by 2. Now, this is your ability. If you can do this all in one step, do it all in one step. If you got to break it down, I think you guys can do it all in one. So we're going to flip and multiply. So that becomes my 4 moles of NH3 in the gaseous form yields. I go from synthesis to decomp. It yields 2 moles of the N2 gas plus 6 moles of the hydrogen gas. And I'm digging it, digging it, digging it. So I would do what do I do to the delta H, Max? Do you remember? Nice. I'm going to multiply by 2. And since I flipped this reaction, what am I also going to do to the sign? Flip the sign. So this is now a positive times 2. We're going to have a 6. Carry the 183. Positive 183. Mm-hmm. Cool. Mm-hmm. And again, kJs per mole, right? kJs per mole. All right. What am I doing to the third and final? What am I doing to the third and final?
Let's see.
What do you think, Brian?
Keep it,
but multiply by 3. What the hell are you talking about? Why are you doing multiply by 3, man?
To achieve the 5 oxygens and the 6 each.
Oh, see, he is thinking about the oxygens. I knew it. I saw the twinkle in your eye, right? Keep the mental anchor, but I love it. If you can figure out the oxygen as you go, it's a beautiful thing. It all lines up, right? But I would have. I'm not as smart as Brian. I just would have saw the 6-piece McNugget needed for the for the water. I would have left it as is, multiplied by 3. So I got my 6 H2s. In the gaseous form, plus 3 O2s in the gaseous form. There's those 5 oxygens. Remember I told you to leave it? Remember I told you to leave it? And Brian was even able to see that. Moving on to my 6 waters, which is what I wanted. Booyakashah. Oh, that's in the gaseous form. Hello. And what am I going to do to the delta H, Brian? What am I doing?
It's going to be multiplied by 3.
Very good. Just multiply this by 3. So I multiply that by 3. 1, carry the 2, 1. Carry the 153, 145, negative 145, 11. Anybody got a calculator?
Yeah.
Oh, no, I don't feel so good about it. Is that it?
Hold on.
They went real quick. Negative 48.37 times 3. Right? So while we're doing that, while we're waiting for that, now I just have to make sure. Remember, in order to be a reaction mechanism, after you flip a source and everything, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Concurrence? Nice. Once we do all the flip a source and all that other fun stuff, we then have to make sure that it does, in fact, add back up and squishy back up to be the original equation I wanted. So I have nitrogen gas over here on the left side. I have nitrogen gas. Wait a minute. What do we call things that go in and then come out? What are those called? We see them in the reactants first, the product second. That is a
catalyst.
Nice. Catalyst. Two-piece going in, two-piece coming out. So they cancel each other out, which is fantastic because I don't see any just pure nitrogen in my reactants. The 5 moles of oxygen here. No moles of oxygen in the products, and as Brian already kind of showed us, right, I do have the 5 moles of oxygen gas total because I had 2 in the first reaction, 3 in the second reaction, and booyakashah, that's beautiful, man. That's beautiful. We got that 5 right there. I like to work through all my reactants first, then my products, so I'm going to come back to my reactant in the second reaction. 4 moles of ammonia, 4 moles of ammonia. I don't see it anywhere, so yeah, buddy, we're just going to rewrite that 4 moles of ammonia. And again, that's also amazing to hear because that's exactly what I wanted. I'm hoping that the other reactants cancel out. I already added the oxygen, so I'm just hoping to get rid of 6 H's over here. Whoa, what is this? The H first appears in a product form and then gets used up as a reactant. That's not a catalyst. That is an
intermediate.
Nice. That's the intermediate guy, right? So we're going to get rid of that intermediate. Woo! Thank God, because those are the 2 reactants I wanted, which I got. It's okay that they're out of order. It doesn't matter, just that they're on the left side. So now I go over to the right side. All I had surviving from the first reaction was the 4 moles of the nitrogen monoxide. All I have left, the second one, lost both products. The third one, there's my 6 moles of water. And as ugly as that started, look how beautiful that works its way out. So if I wanted to solve what the delta H is, I now, because all I had to do was add, essentially all you did was add reaction 1 to reaction 2 to reaction 3. What do I do to the delta H's now? All I do to them is just
add them
up. And I'm not even going to try and do this in my head. Somebody with a calculator, I don't feel like thinking that much. I've already thought too much tonight. I made it here. That alone was thinking enough. Right. So I would add up my positive 361.2 kJs per mole plus a positive 183.6 kJs per mole plus a negative 105.1. And what did we get? What did you get, Brian?
399.69.
Positive?
Yes.
399.1? 69 kilojoules per mole. Is that endothermic or exothermic?
Endothermic.
Endothermic. Would we say that's thermodynamically favorable, aka spontaneous?
No.
No way, Jose B. But we still found the delta H. We found our delta H the third and final way. So whether you start with calorimetry, whether you use the summation-based math for fusion, for formation, or for bonding, or whether you use enthalpy, all 3 ways we can get delta H, and it could be positive, it could be negative, it could be endo, it could be exo, right? Now with that, right, we have to think about the bonds. We have to think about, again, phase changes and how we can use this idea of energy and specifically heat energy. And we have three different, well, really six different phase changes. Anybody remember what sublimation is? Sublimation is when you go from a
gas to a solid,
solid to a gas, right? Yeah. Solid to a gas. That's that really cool thing that dry ice does. If you've ever seen dry ice, that's sublimation, that like smoky look to it on the outside. What's melting? Melting.
Solid.
Nice. That's solid to a liquid. And then ultimately evaporation. Some people call it boiling. Water is actually the only substance that experiences the phenomenon of boiling. Fun fact of the night for you. Evaporation. What's that? That's going from what phase to what phase? Nice. That's from liquid to gas. Notice how I put these three in red? That's because those three, when you see red, what do you think? Hot, think like heat, think like, I think energy going in. Okay. I know fired up. As soon as you said X, I was like, that does make sense. I think making the object hot. I'm sorry. I don't put myself in the center of the universe. I try and think of the other objects for you. It's not me be the system, but it be the system. Either way. Right. Those are all your endothermic phase changes. You have to put energy in. Because what are you doing with intermolecular forces as you sublimate, you melt, or you evaporate? What are you doing with them? You are breaking. Oh, you're breaking intermolecular forces. So intermolecular forces act just like intramolecular forces. Holy cow. All right, flip side to that. We got some deposition. We got some freezing. I'm freezing in here. Really? Where's the liquid becoming a solid? Oh, I gave away. Spoiler alert. And then condensation. So what's deposition? When you go deposit money, you're putting it in the bank. Deposition is the opposite of sublimation. It's going from a gas directly down to a solid, right? Directly down to a solid. Freezing, right? That's now when that liquid is becoming that solid. It's the opposite of melting. And evaporation is liquid to gas. Well, condensation is gas down to a liquid. So I made the other in red because you put energy into them. You have to heat them up. You have to make them warm. But we're not breaking intermolecular forces here. We are forming them, just like intramolecular bonds. We're forming intermolecular forces. And so what is that? That's not endo. Those are?
Exo.
Nice. Exo. Now, heating curves, cooling curves. I think I actually did not go over this with you guys this year. So it's fantastic that you guys are here at the night sesh. Whoops-a-daisy. But you went over these in Chem 1. You go over them in middle school, but they still show their faces up here. So this is a heating curve. How do I know that this is a heating curve? Because where's the origin? The origin is at like 0, 0. At time 0, my temperature, aka my kinetic energy, is at 0. So what state of matter do you start with that has like a temperature of 0? What state of matter is that usually?
Solid,
and then it works its way up and gets hot over time. Conversely, how do I know that this one's a cooling curve? Because I'm starting with a very high temperature, and what's happening to the cooling curve over time?
It's getting
lower and lower, so I'm taking energy out. A lot of times what they like to do is they like to label these things like A, B, C, D, E, and F. You'll see like the different apexes actually identified for you, okay? From A to B, what do you notice about the temperature? From A to B, what's happening to the temperature? Temperature is actually increasing, right? Well, from A to B, there's only one state of matter present. There's only one state of matter present. That state of matter is what? What's the lowest energy state of matter?
Solid only.
Believe it or not, as you hold an ice cube in your hand, before it starts to melt, that ice cube gets heated up. You ever take an ice cube out of your freezer?
Mm-hmm.
Does it start melting immediately? It takes like maybe 5 to 10 seconds. Okay, it's not the best example in the world. Sorry. Right? But you get ice cream. All right, does the ice cream start to melt? Well, actually, you see my Hoffman's ice cream stay. Believe it or not, it stays as just a solid. Because all of the energy that's going in, this is a heating curve. So what do you think heating curves are? If I'm heating an object, is that endo or exo? Endo. If I'm heating an object, this is, again, a form of endothermic discussion. So endo, it's going in. So all the temperature that I'm putting in is allowing the solid particles to start doing more to penguin. I do it a penguin. They do more and more of the penguin. What the heck is going on with B to C? Because B to C... I am still heating the object. I'm still putting fire on the object. I'm putting the ice cube in my hand. I'm still heating the object. Energy is still going in, but what's happening to temperature? Is temperature changing? No. all of the energy that you're putting in is taking that solid and making it a liquid. What do we call that?
Melting.
When you go from a solid to a liquid, that's a phase change. The phase change we call is
melting.
Melting. So this is your melting phase change. That's your melting phase change. Even though you're still heating up the object, the temperature doesn't change because instead of I do it a penguin, now I start to believe that, like, oh, maybe I can, like, move my arms a little bit. Now we actually start to break the intermolecular forces. Now temperature isn't changing because all the energy is not making the molecules move faster. It's making the molecules move further apart. You're actually breaking intermolecular forces. So from B to C, you actually have two states of matter. You have solid and liquid. Once that last ice cube melts, you ever have a cup of water out? You ever have a nice glass of ice water out? And you ever kind of like sip on it? And it seems to stay that nice, delicious, cold temperature until that last ice cube melts. And then the next sip you take, you ever notice how warm it is? Mm-hmm. That's the really scary thing about when the polar ice caps finally melt. Guess what? We're that glass of ice water. So it's going to be real scary. But there's two states of matter. Once that last ice cube melts, bang, from C to D. I'm still heating it. I'm still putting energy in. It's going in, and it's going to go hard, and it's going to go hard. So what's happening to temperature again from C to D? The temperature is actually going back up. So what does that tell you about the kinetic energy? The kinetic energy of the particles is going up on a Tuesday. Well, Thursday, not Thursday. Well, from C to D, guess what? That is liquid only. The sloped parts of heating and cooling curves are actually only one state of matter. Because all the energy is going in to make it move faster and faster. So now it thinks it can burny. Now it thinks it can hit some different moves. And now they're moving faster and faster and faster. And then all of a sudden, it plateaus again. Why do you think it plateaued again? That first plateau is melting. What do you think is happening from D to E?
Evaporation.
Oh, snibbity snap. There's no delta T, right? There's no delta T. All that liquid is becoming a gas. This is what's called the delta H, the heat of fusion. This part from B to C, your melting point is the heat of fusion. Anybody remember what the D to E is? That's also referred to as the heat of vaporization, right? Sounds really fancy. This is the heat of fusion. Heat of fusion is just a fancy name for melting point. Heat of vaporization, really fancy name for, guess what? Evaporation. Again, no change in temperature, because even though I'm evaporating, even though I'm hitting it, boiling water is actually cooler than steam. Boiling water stays at what temperature? What degree Celsius? Boiling water is 100 degrees Celsius, and that's it, unless you throw some salt in there. We do it for taste, now you don't. Right? But unless you throw some salt in there, it's going to be 100 degrees. And the entire time that you boil water, it stays at that 100 degrees. It never gets hotter. Even though you keep giving it all the heat in the world, you keep firing it up, you keep it on that stove, full blast the whole time, guess what? Never gets any hotter. Stays exactly at a 100. Because all the energy is not making it move faster. What did we say is happening to the energy? The kinetic energy isn't going up, God bless you. Moving faster, I'm moving further apart. I'm breaking intermolecular forces again. All right, E to F, all of a sudden temp's going up again. Increase in temperature, that tells me there's only one state of matter present. What's the only state of matter from E to F? Gases. All right, so if you're ever running late and you think, hey, I'll just turn the iron on and iron the clothes while they're on me, like, it'll save time because I won't have to take the clothes off. I won't have to put the clothes on the ironing board. Then I won't have to put the clothes back on me. Just be careful. Oh, and definitely don't hit the steam button. Yeah.
Obviously.
Yeah, you think you'd be smart enough to not know to do something that dumb. But yeah, the steam is hotter than boiling water. It will scar you. It will leave you scarred. Yeah. Not that ever. Okay. Sad. Right? So that's a heating curve, right? Got to be able to talk about it. Got to specifically be able to talk about temperature or kinetic energy. Why does the temperature level out? Because even though I'm heating it, I'm breaking intermolecular forces. I'm not moving faster. Guess what? Everything but opposite coming back down the other way. They sometimes will hit you at the cooling curve. A, B, C, D, E, and F yet again. This is now exo. See how the energy is slowly over time releasing? This is an exothermic process. These are all those exothermic phase changes I was just talking to you about. Now, from A to B, I had a slope, so there's only one state of matter, and the energy and temperature was going up. What's happening to A to B here? Again, I have a slope, so temperature is changing. What's happening to temperature, though? Temperature is going
down.
down, and this isn't a solid only, what's the highest energy state of matter to begin with?
Gas.
So this is actually gas only. All right, so temperature is slowly going down. What's happening from B to C? What's that state of matter when you go from a gas to something else? What's next in line after gas is?
Liquid.
Liquid, right? No delta T, because now I'm not breaking intermolecular forces. What am I doing? I'm not breaking intermolecular forces. I am making them or forming them, right? So this is gas going down to a liquid. That's that condensation, right? Condensation. That's that other phase change. From C to D, again, I have a loss in energy. So the energy is actually coming out. We have a delta T going down. I do have a slope, so only one state of matter. What state of matter is that? Liquid only, right? Liquid only. And then from D to E, what's happening from D to E? Again, no delta T, because all of that energy that's being released is allowing us to make intermolecular forces, make intermolecular bonds. And this is a liquid becoming a solid. What do we call that?
Freezing.
Now, I tried to make this somewhat accurate, but it's kind of hard to fit all these notes on the board. But I hope that you kind of see this. Do you notice the length between B and C versus D and E? And do you notice the length between D and E and B and C? It is a lot harder to evaporate things or to condense things than it is to melt things. Think about it. You can melt an ice cube in the with the power of your hand, but I don't really know anybody who can. At least they haven't come forward to me with their mutant power yet. But I don't really know anybody who can boil water with their bare hand. Okay? It takes a lot of energy, and it takes a lot longer. All right? It takes a lot of energy. It takes a lot longer. An ice cube will melt pretty damn quick. It will not evaporate as fast. It's going to take longer. So that heat of vaporization is usually a lot longer, a lot bigger than the heat of fusion. The heat of vaporization is usually bigger than the heat of fusion. So just another little fun fact for you. Last one, E to F. I do have temperature going down. So that means there's only one state of matter left. What's the only state? What's the lowest energy state of matter?
Solid.
Solid only. All right, solid only. So those are your heating curves. Phase diagrams. We did throw these in very quickly, right towards the end of like our lectures and stuff. Phase diagrams. Anybody remember like what to think or what to say about a phase diagram?
Each of them have a different
What's that?
State of matter.
Okay. Perfect. So let's start on the left. Let's start with something with very low temperatures.
Solid.
And maybe, so solids, right? This is going to be our solid. This is our liquid. That's our gas. All right. Any phase diagram they ever throw at you, what's low in temp and probably would be under high pressure? Well, if you squish things together by putting them under really high pressures and keep them at really low temperatures, you're probably going to be
solid.
A solid. What is this? This phase diagram shows me all of the temperatures and all of the pressures where I will be the different states of matter. What is that called? If you tell me you're starting at one pressure and you're going to go down to a different temperature, or maybe you go to a different pressure and a temperature, if I cross this threshold, what's that? That's going from a solid to a gas. What's going from a solid to a gas?
Sublimation.
Sublimation, right? But if I go from a gas down to a solid, that would be?
Disposition.
Deposition. What if they give you some, they say at some temperature or at some pressure, you increase the temperature. Well, usually if you keep pressure constant, you increase temperature. What happens to solids? They become?
Liquids.
What do we call it if you go from a solid to a liquid?
Melting,
right? Backwards, liquid back down to a solid at a constant temperature, at a constant pressure. There you go. You got your thing, that crazy little thing called freezing, right? Same thing, but opposite with the evaporation and the condensation. Things you have to be aware of, things that you have to be able to talk about, is this first little dot right in the middle. That's called the TP. Anybody remember what that is? Not toilet paper. What is it? Triple point. Very good. Triple point. All right. That's what TP stands for, the triple point. That is the specific set. That is the specific set of temperature and pressure. It's a specific temperature and pressure that you will have a triple. What do you think the triple means? What do you think the triple and triple point stands for? You actually have all three states of matter. It's pretty crazy. It's actually pretty crazy. The other thing that you might see all the way up here is you might see a dot all the way up here. That's called the CP. That's called the CP. We did not go over this in class the other day. That's what's called the critical point. That's what's called the critical point. The critical point is the point at which I don't care how hot you get it. I don't care how much pressure you put it under. You can no longer be a liquid. The critical point, once you go beyond this critical point, I don't care how high pressure you put it under. Once you get past a certain temperature, even if you put it under all the pressure in the world, it's going to actually stay as a gas. They very rarely ask for it. That's why I didn't really go over it in class. All right, but it's the temperature at which it does not matter what pressure, it will always be a gas. What's really, really interesting about these phase diagrams, well, nothing really interesting about them, but what's really interesting about these phase diagrams is that this is the way that water's phase diagram looks, and every other stinking phase diagram, every other one, this triple point hits here, and that line doesn't exist. The line doesn't bend backwards. The line bends forward. Every other one except for water. Water's the only species that does this. So this is earthing. This is earthing, is everything, and the black line is that of which is water. Why does water have such a weird thing? What does water have naturally that no other species has? It has the ability to do what with its intermolecular forces? It has the ability to hydrogen bond. Now, that doesn't sound too special, but not just hydrogen bond once to itself, hydrogen bond twice to itself, right? Definitely one of those things that you got to kind of keep in mind. So they might give you one that looks like this versus that. This is water. That's anything and everything else. Because nothing else in this world, hydrogen bonds twice naturally to itself. Nothing. All right, calorimetry. Q equals MC delta T. What does Q stand for? Q stands for quantity of?
Energy.
Energy. Quantity of heat. Quantity of energy, right? It's just like when you go to the gas station. That's the total quantity of gas, total quantity cost. You go buy a bunch of apples. How much did the apples cost total? Q is your quantity of energy. M is what? M is the mass of the substance. And again, I was hinting at this in the beginning of this board. The mass of the substance, if the substance will dissolve, if they say that you're going to dissolve hydrochloric acid into water, do as you ought to, add the acid to water, which we know is exothermic. It releases energy. If they say you're going to dissolve the hydrochloric acid into the water, what do I do with the mass of the hydrochloric and the mass of the water? If it's going to dissolve in, or if it's two aqueous species that are going to react, and they're going to come together and become one, if they are going to share intermolecular attractions, what do I do with the masses? Very nice. Add together the masses. All right? Add together the masses. Add together mass. If they give me one of those, again, going back to the idea, you take a hot piece of metal, put it in a calorimeter. The metal goes down 60 degrees. Water only goes up 3. What's going on? All that fun stuff. They talk to me about just putting something in the water. It won't dissolve. It doesn't dissolve. It's not going to get in between the intermolecular forces. What do I do with the mass in Q equals MC delta T? It's just the mass of the water. It's just mass of water. Mass of H2O only. It's the mass of the surroundings only, not both. Not both. What are we almost always getting the delta T of? The delta T is always that of the surroundings. The C is usually that of water, which is 4.18, 4.2. So if it's delta T of the surroundings, we just took care of mass. What's Q going to be? Q is actually not going to be that of the system. It's going to actually be that of the
surroundings.
So remember, whenever they give you the calorimetry problem, because they're going to give you one, either open-ended or maybe multiple choice, maybe both. When they give you the calorimetry, remember that you are always measuring the temperature of the water, aka the surroundings. Don't forget to flip the sign, please. Don't do all that work. Then don't do the delta H. Don't do Q divided by moles and forget the delta S. Or I'm sorry, the delta T was that of the surroundings. So we need to flip it. Going back to this idea of the mass, ladies and gentlemen, if I do the mass here, remember, if we do add them together, when I come back over here and solve for Q, remember it would be just the mass of that reactant. So if they said you dissolve the hydrochloric acid into water, you use both masses together in here, but if they want to know what the delta H is, I use just the mass of the HCl to find the moles of the HCl, not the mass of both. Seeing that feeling?
Can you Questions? Say that one more time?
So if I was talking about hydrochloric acid dissolving in water to find Q,
mm-hmm.
I add the mass of the HCl and the water together.
Mm-hmm.
I find my Q and I do all that math.
And you flip it.
Now, and then I flip it. And then they want me to find delta H.
Mm-hmm.
When I go to find moles,
you use the mole only just the H.
Just the HCl, not the HCl in the water. So I got to use the mass of just the HCl to find the moles of just the HCl.
Okay.
Okay. Great, great clarifying. Yep. No, if they ever ask you anything about the system. So almost always. The only time you wouldn't flip it is if they ask you how much energy did the water absorb, or how much energy went into the water, or how much energy did the water lose.
Do they need to be
Not usually, no. I assumed I knew what your question was going to be. They usually ask for that of the system, so not the water, the thing that is actually. So you do usually have to flip it. The only time you really want is if they say how much energy went into the water, how much energy went into the surroundings, what the surroundings lose, what the surroundings gain. Okay? All right, so I'm going to take a couple quick pictures like I've been doing. Nice. So it's only about an hour. Perfect. We're rocking and rolling. So I got to clear this board. There is a little bit more to big idea five. We got to do like entropy and then Gibbs free energy. But same thing. Like you can take a nice little break ski.
Are you talking on the roll thing?
No, that's going to be part of it. Equilibrium is really quick if you think about it. It's really just equilibrium is a thing. These are case statements, the Chatham principle, and then it's all on statements.
Are we doing it today?
Yeah. I'm going to try. Yeah. That's the hopeful idea.
Did you win?
Anybody get Tom a coffee? He needs one.
Wait, what?
Anybody get Tom a coffee? He needs one.
Where you go?
I think maybe went for a walk to get the blood.
Did you see me hit him?
He got, when he got here, he said, he's like, I'm exhausted. He's like, I should take a nap.
Yeah, you're not here.
Yeah, I was like, take a nap. That's okay.
Here,
remember, you got a hot mic over here. Remember, you got a hot mic. Don't miss this.
He broke his ankle in practice? He's such an idiot.
Did he choose to break his ankle?
This kid has broken his ankle so many times.
This year.
Like, he, like, rolls around in his super.
I was like, what?
I've told him that. So if he's watching us, which there's no way he is.
Love you, Mina.
Bye.
You always have those where I never think you're listening, and then you just come in with your comments, my heart. For what? Yeah. Miss Gertis is the best. I love Miss Gertis. I sit with her every day during lunch. Shout out, Miss Gertis. He's back. Do you drink coffee? That sucks. You should drink coffee. What? That's the point. So you don't go to sleep. It doesn't like wake you up like on the movies, like it just keeps you awake. Like, yeah, my heart palpitates, but like I still feel like I'm tired. Like, you get palpitations. That's what happens because you know you're overlapped. Because you, like, you know how you drink tea and you come to class. You drink coffee because it's, like, nice and warm and cozy. Like my mom, she can drink coffee for the bedroom. Like 3 o'clock, coffee for the bedroom.
No, she's dead.
I was thinking.
No. Why? You need to know everything, so. And you're not even taking notes. Yeah, okay. No, thank you. I know you're fellow doctor, so I'll be
here. He has a long practice of 5 minutes. You guys literally practiced for 5 minutes.
Oh, roasted!
You practiced for 5 minutes and you guys left. You went out at 2:10. That was back in the pool.
Oh, 5 minutes.
I was hoping that little bus was still there.
That's like nothing.
It was like 70 degrees
out. What?
It was like 70 degrees out.
What are you doing? That's my photo, though. It's not so hot. No, you always find something.
No, you don't.
You're always miserable in the cross.
We're taking a poll.
Don't say anything about anything because Colin's might be watching. Because, you know, AP exams, crazy guidance counselors. You never know. What?
That just disappeared and walked over to the oh, because the catcher like swung and like threw the bat back and then like, first and hit the catcher. Okay. And then the second time, like,
there.
And then the like, screech. you got ejected.
Thank you.
I was doing the scoreboard and I was looking up
And then our quick seal is
grab a little water real quick, guys. I'll be right back.
Okay.
So, you want to get ahead of the notes?
Take your time. What? You need the middle. Yes, you do. I'm waiting for you. I see this.
Like a little bit more, but still a nice little chunk of Big Idea 5, and then we'll jump into Big Idea 6, which basically that's all the equilibrium stuff, and then I'll erase the board and we'll fill the board with acids and bases, and then we're done for the night. Look at that. So for the year, for the night and for the year. Oh my god. All right, so here we go. So the first law is all about enthalpy. It's all about energy can't be created or destroyed, heat energy can't be created or destroyed, give and take, right? The other thing about the universe is that the universe is only always getting bigger. It's only ever becoming more and more random. So remember, randomness, right? Randomness, delta S, randomness is not and does not mean stability. Randomness, does not mean spontaneity. Randomness means disorder. Disorder! There's this band called System of a Down. They have an awesome CD called Toxicity. Go buy it. Go listen to it. It's great. Let it wash over you. All right, but it is not. We often, a lot of people when they teach us, a lot of people when they read this, a lot of people think
that it just means, like, well, if you're disordered, it just means that you're spontaneous and crazy. And then you're going to do something nuts. Like, no, remember, spontaneity isn't if you're disordered or not. Spontaneity means once we get over activation energy, will you continue to happen? Are you thermodynamically favorable? So please do not fall into the trap of trying to call it what some of the old people do. Don't fall into the trap of thinking that S is for spontaneity. No. S is for randomness. Like what Macklemore does in the one song. Right? If I have, so I'm always looking, right? And things are always looking. What do they want to do? Things always want to become
more bigger.
Want to become more or less disordered. Want to become more
disordered,
more random, right? This is why your life is a mess. It's not your fault. It's the universe. This is why your bedroom is a mess. It's not your fault. It's what the universe wants. It's not on us, right? It's not on us. It's not my, fault. I didn't want this, right? If I get a delta S, because I can actually calculate delta S. There is another way. There is a way to relate H to S, but they very rarely pull that out. But if I ever calculate for delta S, which could be summation-based math, maybe they give me G, they give me H, and they give me T. But if I ever get a positive delta S for that of the system, that tells me that the system, well, we don't really have like the system surrounding things, if you ever notice that. We don't really have to worry about, well, are you talking about the system and the surroundings? Entropy is almost always exclusively from the system's perspective. So you don't have to do any of that, flip it, do I not flip it? You're always talking about the system. So if delta S is ever positive, what does that mean? Is it becoming more ordered or more disordered? More disordered, right? More crazy, more disordered. And therefore, is that thermodynamically favorable?
Yes.
Yes, sir. Yes, that is thermodynamically favorable. That is what we would consider or what we would classify as spontaneous, but we don't call it that anymore. We say it's thermodynamically favorable once you get over that activation energy. If I get a delta S that is negative, that tells me what? It's not becoming more disordered. It's becoming
less
disordered. Or if you wanted to, you could think of it as more ordered. The only problem is now you're talking about doing like more for both. So delta S becoming positive, more randomness, more craziness, more just papers all over the place and all that other fun stuff. Delta S is negative, right? It can happen. Your bedroom can be clean. It's not going to happen naturally on its own. It's going to happen when you put energy in or what we would say not thermodynamically favorable, right? And nobody in this world has ever just come home and the room was clean just out of the grace of God. Maybe you hired some help. Maybe your brother or sister owed you a favor. Maybe your parents just felt like doing you a solid. Maybe they were looking for something. They felt guilty, so then they just decided to clean your room as a cover-up. You know, I don't know. Whatever you have going on. I don't know. Right? How about as we go back to those phase changes, before we leave this whole idea of energy behind and we get into equilibrium, if I go from a solid to a liquid, or if I go from a liquid to a gas, solid to liquid, what's that called?
Melting.
Liquid to gas.
Evaporation,
right? This is the endothermic phase changes. What about if I go directly from a solid to a gas? What's that called?
Sublimation.
Those are all endothermic, which according to enthalpy, they're like, nah, man, I ain't doing that. That ain't thermodynamic. That ain't my thing, man. That ain't my bag, baby. That's not what I'm looking for, right? However, what's happening for delta S is I go from a solid, do it a penguin, to make it a pizza, to pop, drop, and lock it. Pop, drop, and lock it. As I go from a solid to a liquid to a gas, what's happening to the randomness of the molecules? Are they becoming more or less? Bless you.
They're becoming more random.
You are becoming more random. Delta S is positive. Bless you.
Bless you.
This is why if you actually leave a glass of water out in your house, in your bedroom, or something somewhere, you leave a glass of water out, even though it's not 100 degrees Celsius, and even though it's not spontaneous according to enthalpy, that cup of water will eventually evaporate, completely evaporate, because to go from liquid molecules all the way up to gaseous particles, even though the universe doesn't want to give the energy, it's worth it for the randomness gained. All right, how about if I go the opposite way? How about if I go from a gas down to a liquid? What's that called?
Condensation.
Liquid down to a solid, freezing. And then how about gas all the way down to a solid?
Deposition.
That's the deposition. You are now becoming more ordered, right? We're calming you down. You're releasing energy, so your enthalpy is happy because you're giving away all that energy to calm down, but your entropy, your randomness is kind of like, no, this is not cool. I don't want to conform. I don't want to be in order, but it is what it is. So in some cases, usually never, but in some cases, delta H and delta S can agree. In a lot of cases, they don't. So who determines and who figures out and who's like Judge Judy, who's like Judge Mills Lane, all that fun stuff? That's our Gibbousa. Our Gibbousa free energy, right? Gibbs actually listens and sits there and it evaluates the delta H and it evaluates delta S at a specific temperature. And it listens to the argument from delta H. Delta H is saying, hey, I'm positive, I'm endothermic. I don't think we should do this change. I don't think this is thermodynamically favorable. Delta S might agree. Delta S might be like, you know what? Yeah, I'm negative two. I'm not about it, Judge. And then we decide. But delta G listens to both sides, right? Its job is to determine the overall thermodynamic favorability. Its overall thermodynamic favorability. God, I wish I could spell. Favorability, right? AKA whether it's going to be spontaneous or not, right? We're going to use the word spontaneous, but we're not going to use that in our open-ended answers or anything because we will be awarded no points, and may God have mercy on our soul, all right? What it really is, what delta G really is it's the overall free energy. That's why it's called Gibbs free energy. It's the overall free energy. What it actually does is it listens to everything. It listens to the enthalpy, it listens to the entropy, it listens to the temperature, and in the overall for the system and the surroundings, and it looks at the entire universe. It's very high-level stuff that this does. You'll do it like junior year of college chemistry. We don't have to worry about it. We just have to be able to apply it. But it looks at the overall free energy of not the system, not just the surroundings, but the system and the surroundings. And I didn't want to show this to you in class because I don't want the head to explode, but oh God, here it goes. If we were to somehow become one with the surroundings, if we, the system, became one with the surroundings, we would now have created what we call a universe. When you take in mind the idea of what the system's doing, what the surroundings doing, now you're talking about the entire everything in the world. You're talking about a universe. You're talking about a universe. All right, what kind of delta G's do we want in order to be spontaneous? If delta G is positive, is that spontaneous? Is that thermodynamically favorable?
No.
Turns out, no, this is not thermodynamically favorable, right? We want negative delta G's. Overall, I want everybody to be happy. I want like a perfect societal utopian idea of like what socialism or communism could be if everybody was just equal and everybody just lived. Not that I'm saying it's good, I'm not saying become one. I'm just saying if everybody was happy, everybody got everything they wanted in the world, that's what would delta G would be if it was negative. If everybody got to get rid of their, imagine if everybody right now, we could just get rid of our stress. Imagine if we all just, bam, we all just got fives. We all just, we found a pot of gold and it was free fives and free $5 million. Think about what we could do. Think about what this group, what we would do. We would take over the world, right? We would take over the world, right? Delta G, actually, I would go hide somewhere in the world because I hate people, but that's a different story, right? Delta G is negative. Delta G is negative. What does that tell you? Is that good? Oh, yeah. Yeah, buddy. That is what we do want. We always want negative delta G's. We want everybody to release their stress. We want everybody to get rid of it. So this arrives a problem, and this is the age old. When you go to the reference sheet, these next three equations are on the reference sheet. And if you are very good at algebra, this breakdown, which usually beats everybody up every year, is your friend. If you're not good at algebra, you can just memorize this, but it's a little rough. Now, if I want delta G's to always be negative, I got to think about the different situations I could have. If I have a delta H that is positive, if I have a delta H that is positive, what is H saying as far as thermodynamically favorable? Is H about that life? Is H all about being a thermodynamically favorable, aka spontaneous, if it's positive?
No.
H is saying, my heart is saying yes, but my brain is saying no. Ooh, right? Enthalpy is saying no. Enthalpy is saying no, this is a bad idea. Enthalpy is saying no, I do not want to be thermodynamically favorable. Not. This is this black not. What about entropy being positive, though?
Saying
so
yes.
Enthalpy is saying no, but what is entropy saying? Entropy is actually saying
yes.
All right, well, who's right, who's wrong? This is where we have to think a little bit. Now, also, usually, keep in mind that delta H is usually KJs, and entropy is usually J's. So remember, we got to usually kind of think about that and make sure that we're dotting our I's and crossing our T's and the units are the same. So let's pretend we have a very low T. Let's pretend that we have very low T. All right, I am getting old, so you never know, right? So if we're talking about a low temperature, okay? If I have a low temperature, delta H is saying no. And if I have a low temperature, think of delta T and delta S as a package deal. If temperature is very low, does entropy have a realistic opportunity to be greater than H, so that therefore this negative times a positive times a positive, so therefore a negative total, if this is a low temperature, does entropy have the opportunity to overpower enthalpy? What do you think? Mm-hmm. Not really. If temperature is very low, so in this scenario, in the case where they're both positive, for low temperatures, for low Ts, delta G, it too is going to be positive. The enthalpy is going to win. The enthalpy is too big of a value. Temperature is too small. It's not going to allow entropy to overtake enthalpy. So delta G is positive. Is that spontaneous? Is that thermodynamically favorable? Delta G ends up being positive.
No.
So at low temperatures, we are not spontaneous. But what about at higher temperatures? Well, at higher temperatures, if this is a huge number times entropy, a big number times entropy, isn't that going to make this whole value become like a really huge number?
Mm-hmm.
And if that number becomes huge and there's a negative outside it,
mm-hmm.
don't I now have a chance that this combined T times S has the opportunity to combine and be greater than H? So when I take H minus this, don't I have the opportunity to get a negative delta G?
Yes.
And I do, and I will. So if you ever have a positive delta H and a positive delta S, you are thermodynamically favorable, thermofaves, at what temperatures? Only at
high
temperatures, baby, at high temps. They love asking a question, like was on your final. Which of the following sets of data is not spontaneous at lower temperatures, but gradually becomes spontaneous at higher temperatures? Well, at low temperature, S can't overpower it. At lower temperature, S can't overpower it. That's fine. A lot of people, you just have to skip it. But every year, they ask that question to some degree. Right? Every year, they ask that question to some degree. All right. How about this scenario? How about negative delta H? Is that good? Negative delta H, is that saying like, yes, let's be spontaneous?
Yeah.
Negative delta H is like, yes. But what about negative delta S?
No.
No. Do, 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 do. No. So who's right, who's wrong?
Yeah.
Well, they're arguing. This is delta G's job. So again, let's think about it in terms of a low temperature. Let's think of it in terms of a low temperature. Let me go back and change this. Yes. No. Change that into blue. There we go. Yes. At low temperatures. At very low temperatures. Again, if this is very low, when I multiply times entropy, this is going to be a low value overall with me. If temperature is very low, a low number times a number is going to be a low number, right? And if this was negative, I have a low negative, but what's outside my parentheses? Another negative. So that negative really becomes a positive. So at very low temperatures, this is going to be a low value. So that negative times that negative is going to be a very low positive. And I have a very high negative here. So is this going to be able to overtake the negative? Nope. And so at low temperatures, I don't have a positive delta G value. At low temperatures, I have a negative delta A or delta G value. So what do you notice? At low temperatures, who wins? Regardless of what they say, at low temperatures, who's the winner, winner, chicken dinner? At low temperatures, the enthalpy. And what's enthalpy? Enthalpy is the energy related to what? To heat. If I ask you to borrow $5? Can I borrow $5? Is $5 to you a lot of money right now?
Right now, five bucks
is a lot, right? So if it's cold outside, maybe it's cold outside. Think I should stay, right? If it's cold outside, that temperature is a big enthalpy. It's a big deal. If temperature is very low, enthalpy is a huge deal. You ask me for $5, what are you gonna do for it?
I'm
I ain't just giving you $5. We bump into Tim Cook. We bump into Tim Cook. Is $5 a lot to Tim Cook, the guy who runs Apple? $5 a lot to him? You're drones to his technology and you give him all of your money and you don't even know who he is. He's your overlord. You don't know
who knows?
He
might be cheap.
If you, maybe, but if you're a billionaire, is $5 a lot of money to you?
No.
So if there's a lot of temperature, enthalpy isn't the one winning. Who's winning? Who's winning if it's a high temperature? If it's a high temperature, it's always the entropy.
Yeah, okay.
So in this case, again, temperature at low temperatures. It's hard to understand. Yep.
In Kelvin's, temperature will be negative, right?
Correct. Temperature will never be negative. Temperature will always be positive. S can be positive. S can be negative. Yep. All right. How about the last one? These last two were nice and easy. These are real fast, real furious. How about the last two? Well, what do we got getting up with the getting down right here? What do we got getting up with the getting down with if I have a positive enthalpy? Is that a yes or a no for thermodynamically favorable? Positive?
No.
What about negative for delta H? Is that a yes or a no?
No.
We always want negatives and positives. So this is a no, and that's a no. You can't triple stamp and double stamp. It will never, don't you ever come around here. Don't you ever come around here ever again. Those will never be. Any situation that has a positive enthalpy, it needs energy to keep going, and this is your bedroom. In order to clean your bedroom, you have to constantly put energy into your bedroom to make it become more ordered. Definitely not going to ever be spontaneous. Never going to be spontaneous ever. How about with, trying to find a color I haven't really used. What about if I have a negative delta H? What's that? Is that spontaneous? Is that thermodynamically favorable?
Yes.
Right? Big time, yes. And then what about a positive delta S? Is that?
Yes.
Come on.
That's a pretty bad
comment. So if enthalpy is saying, let's do this, and entropy is saying, let's do this, what do you think about delta G? Is delta G ever going to be spontaneous? Is it ever going to be thermodynamically favorable?
Oh, hell yeah.
Heck yeah, dude, it's going to actually...
Oh my God.
Stupid rabbit, tricks are for kids. Always, right? Always. At all temperatures. So here's what's crazy. If the signs are the same, that's why I got some explaining to do. Positive, positive, low temperatures, I am not spontaneous. High temperatures, I am spontaneous. Negative, negative, low temperatures, I am spontaneous. High temperatures, I am not spontaneous. Positive, negative, if the signs are opposite, then it's going to be an always or a never. Positive, that's a no. Negative, that's a no. I don't care. I don't care how much you heat it up. I don't care how much you cool it down. You will never, ever. I don't care in the summer or in the winter, my bedroom doesn't clean itself. It doesn't just come home and magically me. Right? Negative and positive, though, that will always be. Some of the other things that they bring in are delta G, right? We could also bring in delta G. Negative NFE, what does that have to do with? What form of delta G is this? This has to do with? Nice. Electrochem. And if I'm talking about delta G, I always want delta G to be negative. I'm going to have the negative on the outside. What's N stand for? N stands for number of?
Moles of electrons.
Nice. Number of moles of electrons, which is always going to be positive. F stands for Faraday's constant, which is always going to be a positive. So what kind? So I have positive number of moles, positive F. What kind of E's do we want? What kind of voltages for cells do we want? Positive or negative voltages? Positive, right? So you know how to keep that all together. This is another form of delta G. So if we wanted to link not only thermodynamics, not only to electrochem, but if we wanted to rank it too, and that's capital K, what does that have to do with? That has to do with?
Equilibrium.
Oh, look at the natural transition. It's almost like this guy planned it. It's almost like he kind of thought about it, right? This is how I would relate it back to equilibrium. But what's interesting about that, right, is we have to use the 8.314 version of R. We're looking for that version of R. All right, it's going to have joules in it. You'll see it on the reference sheet. Okay, but if they ever ask you, if they give you, or if you calculated delta G and they ask you about the equilibrium constant, that's your equation. And both of them, again, are on the reference sheet. Okay, all right.
Here we go. Here we go. Full speed. Moving and grooving.
Grooving and moving.
All right, moving on. So big idea number six is all about equilibrium, acids and bases, titrations, and solubility. So with equilibrium constants, remember there's a whole kit and caboodle. There's a whole bunch of them, all right? But for equilibrium constants, with kinetics, all I ever cared about were the reactants. But for equilibrium constants, what do I care about? Do I care about reactants and products? Yeah, buddy, right? So for equilibrium constants, it's always going to be products over reactants, right? It's always products over reactants, except what are the only two states of matter that we ever care about?
Aqueous and gas.
Very nice, right? But we only care about gaseous and aqueous, all right? Gaseous and aqueous. If you have, and the reason why we don't care about solids and liquids is because their densities are constant. If I take a piece of something, I take a Kit Kat bar, give me a break. If I break off a piece of Kit Kat bar, not only do I lose the mass of that Kit Kat bar, but I also lose its volume. Wait, what can I turn mass into? I can turn mass into moles. And then what if I do moles divided by volume instead of grams divided by volume? What's that? Molarity. So because density is constant, molarity is constant. So that's why we don't have to worry about solids and liquids in case they ask you. One of the ones, again, I don't really do the best of job with this when we do solubility rules and when we talk about net ionic equations and stuff. But one of the things that we can write an equilibrium constant for is that dissociation. Remember, not everything loves to dissociate, right? Chops not. You have your carbonates, you have your hydroxides, your oxides, your phosphates, and your sulfides. Ides. Just sulfur alone. Just sulfur all alone. Chops. That's a chop. That's not going to happen. What's Na stand for?
Mr.
What form of nitrogen?
NO3.
Nitrate, Mr. Soluble. Him or herself. Acetate is one.
Alkali
metals.
Alkali.
Ammonium. Those are the four that will like always dissolve. Everything else is kind of like you guys, right? Somebody else here probably was like, dude, just come on, everybody else will need a little bit of extra juice. So for things that don't just fully dissociate, if you don't fully dissociate, are you strong or weak? You do not fully dissociate or readily dissociate. You're weak, so you're what we would call a weak electrolyte. So we can look at these things that don't fully dissolve, don't fully dissociate, and they can actually have equilibrium constant statements. So I could take a solid, and it could become its different ion. This was 1x, so for every 1xy, I get 1 mole of x, 1 mole of y. What if this was xy to the 2? Would I still get just 1 mole of x? It was xy 2. Would I get 1 mole of y? No, I would actually get, if this was xy 2, I would actually get 2y, all right? Which then makes it 2x in my ice table, okay? So if they want me to write a KSP, they start to talk to me about dissociation constants or solubility constants, or dissociation statements or solubility statements. This is all they're talking about. The solid becoming its ionic, its constituent ions. So if I wanted to write a case statement for this dissociation as is, remember, it's always, and you have to write capital K, dissociation constant. I think it has to do with like Latin, who freaking knows, right? Who cares about the English language? Just a bunch of sounds. Ooh, 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 ah, 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 right? And they just all of a sudden turn them into words. Whatever. So KSP, it's going to be products. What are the only two states of matter I care for? The only two states of matter I care about are?
Aqueous and gaseous.
So I'm going to write equals. I put that ion in brackets because that means concentration. And I do raise it to the power of its coefficient. Can't do that for kinetics. Have to do that for equilibrium. And then here I'm going to multiply it by the y because that 2 is aqueous. But what do I do to y? Do I do it to the power of 1? Now I do it to the power of 2. And those are, in fact, powers. Those are not orders like they are for kinetics. Those are actually powers. Now I put products over reactants. So what do I put that over?
1.
I put it over 1, or I can put it over nothing at all because my only reactant is a solid, right? So you can do 1 or none, whatever you're feeling comfortable with. All right, so that's a dissociation concept. It's the same thing as everything we've done, just as to a dissociation. And when we start taking that same idea of equilibrium, but now to a reaction, and so we'll pretend like A is gaseous, B is aqueous, we'll pretend like C is solid, and we'll pretend like D is aqueous. So if they ask me to write the equilibrium statement, the equilibrium constant, if they ask me to write the K value, the KEQ or the KC, whatever you want me to write, I can do that. KEQ, sure. KC, sure, whatever you want. It's always what over what again? It's always products over reactants. So I put C in brackets, right? What do you mean though? Oh, derp! This is what is called what? If you have gaseous, aqueous, solid, and aqueous, what kind of equilibrium is that? Homogeneous, homogeneous, or heterogeneous?
Heterogeneous.
Heterogeneous. Remember, when you read these, kind of say that to yourself. Remind yourself, I only care about the aqueous. I only care about the gaseous. And so I would just put D in the numerator. I completely ignore C. And I would raise it to the power of whatever D's coefficient is. And I'm going to put that over. A is gaseous, so I don't put gases, right?
You do.
Oh, no. Oh, sorry, that's right. I do put gases. I don't put solids. I don't put liquids because their densities don't change. But can you take a gas and put it in a smaller volume? Can you take a gas and condense it? So you can manipulate their concentrations. That's why they go in these. All right, so I do put that in there. B is aqueous, and again, we do love aqueous all day. To the power of B. So that would be my KEQ. That would be my K statement. Okay, that would be my KEQ. That would be my K statement. What about if they ask me KPs? What if they ask me KPs though? And P stands for pressure. So let's pretend like actually these two weren't aqueous. Let's pretend like B and D were actually gaseous. So now if you want me to write a KP, KPs only relate to what? KP only, very nice. KP only affects gases, right? So the only thing maybe tell yourself KP is for gases only, but P is for pressure. P is also for parentheses. But to represent partial pressure, I do have to put capital P sub D, and I do still raise it to the power of D. Breaks my heart. Every year I warn you guys about it. Every year a couple people, I get it. There's a lot to remember. There's a lot going on. This is the hardest goddamn class in high school. But every year, if you don't put parentheses and if you don't put capital P because you're not representing partial pressure, you get no points. Sometimes they say literally just write the equilibrium statement for this problem. It's got to be candy, got to be baby. Give me candy, baby. Give me.
Taking candy from a baby is supposed to be easy.
No. Wait, you're like actually writing with the letter P. Didn't know that.
Yeah, capital P, because that's capital P sub whatever means partial pressure of that species. So yes, you do actually have to write the capital P. So thank you for saying that, because that's the exact point. Yeah.
If it was the original equation, like they're all equals except for B, it would be 1 over capital P, B, capital P, B,
sub
B,
B. To the power of B, yep.
Right.
Yeah, would be fun, wouldn't it? Yeah, buddy.
All right, so moving on to Le Chatelier. So we're going to use this reaction for our Le Chatelier principle, our LCP. Yeah, you know me. You down with LCP? Yeah, you know me. You down with LCP? Yeah, you know me. All right, so if we were to look at this, right, if I were to ask you to write me the KP for this one, we'll practice KP since it was a little confusing. What would my KP look like? It's always products over reactants. The product, is it gaseous?
Yeah.
Yeah, buddy. So I'm going to put capital P. Sub NH3, and what do I raise it to the power of?
Two.
Dose. Over. What am I putting first? Parenthesis, capital P, what?
And two
to the power of one. That one's up to you. It's optional.
Times
capital P sub H2 to the power of?
Three.
That would be my KP statement. Okay? Does it matter if I put P sub N here or P sub H there? Does it matter if I put that order? As long as they're both in the denominator and their coefficients are correct. If I ask you to write the KC, it would be the same thing, but then brackets. Right, then brackets. All right, so the first thing that we can do, LCP, first thing that we can manipulate are concentrations, right? Concentration modifications. What's the little acronym we came up with? AATT, baby. AATT. What the flip does that mean? That means if I increase the concentration, or in the cases of gases, concentration or what? Concentration or
pressure,
right? For gases, this could also be pressures. So if they told you started with 0.25 ATMs of H2 and you added an extra 0.5 ATMs of H2, concentration and pressure are like directly related in the world of gases, PV equals NRT, all that fun stuff.
So what does AA stand for? We always shift away from
additions.
So if I add something to the left, if I add something to the left of this equation, which way does it shift? It shifts
right.
to the right. So if I add reactants, I get more products. If I add a reactant, I get more products. With me on that.
Yes.
Does the value of K actually change? No. That's the whole point. That's why it shifts. So that K doesn't change. So if I artificially increase my denominator, I have to fix the numerator in order to get it back to being the same ratio. So we always go away from additions. So if you push up on the left, we're going to shift right. If I increase something on the left, I shift right. What if I increase something on the right? I shift
left.
If I increase a product, I shift in the reverse direction. I enable the reverse. All right, what does TT stand for?
Towards takeaways.
Nice. We go towards takeaways, right? Towards takeaways. If you were to take away something, we're going to go towards that. Because if I take away something, in order for the math to stay the same, I have to shift towards that. So if I pull down on the left, which way do I shift? Nice. If I pull down on the left, I shift left. And if I pull down on the right, I shift right, baby. Shift it right. So AATT for concentrations, which would be only gases or aqueous, or pressures, which would be gases only. This is where it really starts to get fun because we can't just memorize anymore. We can't just say, oh, okay, well, always left or always right. This is where we actually have to do a little bit of thinking, which is really obnoxious. For pressure changes, if I increase pressure by changing volume, remember Vice President Boyle, V and P are inversely related. So if I increase pressure by decreasing volume, which way do I always shift? I always shift to the side with what? Nice. Side with less gas. If I artificially increase pressure, I have to shift so that I can get up or give out or give away that extra pressure. So in this case, in the reaction we're looking at the synthesis of ammonia, 1 mole of nitrogen reacting with 3 moles of hydrogen to produce 2 moles of ammonia. If I increase the pressure in the system by decreasing the volume, which way should it shift? To the left or to the right?
Right.
It's going to shift to the right. If I increase the pressure, there's 4 moles of gas on the left, 2 moles of gas on the right. So if I increase the pressure, the system's going to bug out and say, no, no, no. And it's going to get rid of those extra moles of gas to lower the pressure. Feeling that?
Mm-hmm.
What if you accidentally decrease the pressure? What if you put this in a bigger volume? Well, now it's going to shift to the side with more gas. Right? If I artificially decrease, right? When you stretch a balloon, what happens? The balloon fixes itself to like get back to where it was. And it'll even snap back into place. But if I increase my volume and therefore I decrease my pressure, the gas particles always want to do what? They always want to fill
the
volume of the container. So if you give it empty space, it's going to fill that empty space. But then I have to keep that pressure up. So I have to slide back, not to the right this time. In this case, if I decrease pressure, which way is it going to shift? If I decrease pressure, it actually shifts back to the left because that's the side with more gas. Okay, that's the side with more gas. So again, you can't just say, oh, always shift right, always shift left. You can only ever say if you increase pressure, you always shift to the side with less gas, less pressure. If you decrease pressure, you always go opposite of the change. Increase pressure, go opposite. Where's the side with less pressure, less moles? To the right. Decrease pressure, go to the side with more pressure. What side is more pressure? Left. Feeling that?
Mm-hmm.
This only affects what state of matter?
Gases.
Pressures will only ever affect gases. Mahan, you just said that gas or aqueous. Pressure changes will only LCP gases. What happens if I have equal moles of gas? Which way do I shift if I have equal moles of gas? No. Right? There is no shift. No shift. If you have equal moles of gas, it doesn't matter if you increase or decrease. It does not matter what the hell you do to it. You increase the pressure, good. Good for you. Wonderful. That's what the system does. No shift whatsoever. All right, last thing that we can change is we can change the temperature. If I increase the temperature, that always helps what?
that always enables or always helps which endo or exo?
Endo.
Increasing temperature always helps endo. So I don't know if that means forward. I don't know if that means reverse. I have to think about what was the delta H for the reaction. I have to think about what direction is endothermic. So let me go back and let me tell you that this has a negative delta H, this reaction. So if that has a negative delta H, the forward is what? If that has a negative delta H, the forward is?
Exothermic.
Exo. So that means the reverse is?
Endo.
Increasing temperature always helps the endo. So if this is negative and I increase temperature, which way is it going to shift in this scenario?
Left.
Back to the left. Beautiful. The other thing you can do, right, if we think about this as being exo, you could also write the word heat on the product side because it's being reacted, and then you could think of heat as a modification like concentration. Go away from additions, right? I add on the right side, it would shift back to the left. Feeling that? Okay. How about if I decrease temperature? That always helps the... Always helps the exothermic direction, right? Always helps the exothermic direction. So in this case, a decrease in temperature would help shift it to the right. Again, like pressure, I can't always say always left or always right. I got to think about it. What's the other super crazy thing about temperature? Temperature is also the only thing. It will actually change and it will actually cause an LCP, but it's the only thing that can actually also do what? It's the only thing that can actually change the actual value of K. So we will have a shift. We will have a Le Chatelier shift. But now, whatever that value for K was, if you told me KSP originally was 3.6 times 10 to the negative third, I changed the temperature, all bets are off. That's no longer your K value. It's now gone. All right, feeling that. All right, the last thing with Le Chatelier shifts, or what they might ask you, they might give you a scenario. Again, student B comes in and does it under these conditions. Which way should it shift, left or right? If they ever ask you which way is it going to shift and give you data, or if they ever ask you about reaction quotient, you're talking about reaction quotient, you're talking about Q, and here's the really crazy thing. Q is K, K is Q. What do I mean by that? It's the same format. It's products over reactants. You only care about aqueous and gaseous. Q is K and K is Q. It's just we don't know where we are. We don't know if we're late. We don't know if we passed the place, if we're still on our way to the place, or, oh, my God, you're right here. You're right. Oh, there's Howell High School. Whoopsies. I thought Howell High School would be in Howell, not Farmingdale. Oh, my God. Right? Like, we don't know exactly where we are. But it's the exact same thing. It's products over reactants. And if and when I do a calculation for Q, if Q ends up less than K, that means if Q is less than K, that means that my denominator is larger than it should be. That means that my numerator is smaller than it should be. So if I have less product than I'm supposed to have and I have more reactant than I'm supposed to have, which way is it going to shift to fix it?
To the products.
To the product side. So if Q is ever less than K, we get a shift to the right. We get a shift to create more product. So that I can increase that numerator of Q, decrease that denominator, and A, Jack, now Q gets 2K. What if Q is greater than K? You blew way down Squonkum. You weren't paying attention. You were rocking out. You were listening to Mahan Chem Live. Hey. And you were so enthralled with Mahan. Welcome to the Mahan Show. Hey, how you doing? All right. Thanks for joining us on this wonderful Thursday night. All right. May 2nd. Okay. Yeah. Tough man. Like, you were listening to it and you blew right past high school. So if Q is greater than K, that means that my numerator is larger than it should. My denominator is smaller than it should. So how do I get it? How do I fix it? Which way do I shift? Not right, but
left.
Left. Shift. Learn how to spell. Shift. Left. What if I calculate it all out and Q actually equals K? What does that mean?
No shift.
Holy cow. You were there. You're actually already at equilibrium. You pull up to the high school. You are just out of your skull. You are just so excited. You're just high on life, bro. And you pull up and you see a cop and you're like, excuse me, Ossifer? Where's Howell High School? And they're like, whoa, 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 it's right here, just park your car and I'll get you inside, okay? You're like, thank you, okay, come again, right? You're at equilibrium, all right? You're at equilibrium, all right? How are we feeling about that one? How are we feeling about Q?
Laughing with me, not at me, right, Kayla?
Even better. All right. Yeah. One of the other things we can do is what's called the common ion effect. This is actually one of the ways when we talk about decreasing concentration, when we talk about shifting these things, we could do what's called the common ion effect. What words do you see in common ion effect?
Common ion.
Again, I only got a 580. Ion, right? I only got a 580 in the verbal. If I got 40 points better, I would have saved myself a lot of money. But I can read common ion effect and kind of just take a guess. And maybe it has to do with an ion that's in common. And it has an effect on the situation. Hey, Jack. So if I take something like silver nitrate, silver doesn't really like to dissolve, but Mr. Soluble gets him to actually dissolve. I can add things. I can throw things into this solution that could either be a common ion and help disrupt the equilibrium, or I can put something in there that actually is not a common ion at all, which would help precipitate it out. But let's say I threw in some more sodium nitrate. What if I added sodium nitrate to this situation above? If I add sodium nitrate into this situation, what's going to happen to the sodium nitrate? Well, when I throw that solid sodium nitrate in there, that sodium is going to dissolve and become sodium. Is that a common ion?
No.
No. Is that going to have any effect on the equilibrium of silver nitrate?
No.
Sodium won't, but what about the nitrate? Uh-oh.
Oh, yeah.
Is that a common ion?
Yeah.
Yeah, buddy. So if that's a common ion, by me throwing sodium nitrate in there, even though it isn't silver nitrate, by me throwing sodium nitrate in there, I've now thrown a common ion in. And what have I done? What did you do?
You added to
you
the product.
You increased concentration of a product. So which way did it shift?
To the left.
It's going to actually shift back to the left. So did you make this more soluble, or did you actually make this less soluble?
Less soluble.
Oh, damn. So by throwing in sodium nitrate, you actually made this less soluble.
You suck.
It would start to precipitate out. It would go backwards. It would become the solid. That's one example of a common ion effect. Another example of a common ion effect is if I add something like calcium carbonate. If I added calcium carbonate at first, we look at this and we go, yeah, duh, no common ion, you idiot. And you're right. There is no common ion. But that's a chop. What did we say the C in chops is? Carbonate. Does carbonate like to dissolve?
Yes.
No.
No. Carbonate doesn't really like to dissolve. So now if you put carbonate in there, what do we know about silver? Silver's a funky bunch. Silver's a D-block. Do they like to dissolve?
No.
No. So actually what happens is feathers of a, you know, birds of a feather flock together. Birds of a feather flock together. So the silver actually jumps onto the carbonate and we create a precipitate. We actually get AG2CO3 solid. So even though this isn't a common ion per se, it's technically the common ion effect because you threw in what's called a precipitating agent. You threw something in there that carbonate is going to eat up silver. What happens if I eat up silver? What's that going to do to equilibrium? What's that doing to the concentration of silver if I start to precipitate it out? Oh, so now I'm actually decreasing the concentration of silver. So which way is this going to shift? It's going to actually shift to the right. So you can actually make things more soluble by adding another species that would help dissolve or precipitate out a different species. Technically still called common ion, even though it's not common. With that, what they might ask you too is which one would precipitate out first? The lower my KSP, that means less product. The lower my KSP, that means less ions. The lower my KSP, that means more solid. The lower your K value, the weaker the electrolyte, the more it wants to be to the left. So which of these two, if I told you these two KSPs, which one would precipitate out first?
The second one.
Which one's the lower of the two? This one here is the lower KSP value, which means it would precipitate out first. It does not want to be a product. It does not want to be an ion. It wants to be a solid. It's going to precipitate out first. How are you feeling about that? Okay. All right, here we go. Last push here. Last little push.
Oh,
Arrhenius, acids and bases, and then Bronsted Lowry, acids and bases. Arrhenius was the first guy. First one to come up with acids and bases. And who's the first one to say that acids do what? Acids
donate
What? H plus.
All right, all Arrhenius knew was you either give H's, or if you're a base, you donate what? You donate not H's, but
OH's,
right? Hydroxides. And that made all the sense in the world. And if you don't give H's and you don't give OH's, you're just a stupid, stinking salt if you are an ionic species. So that was Arrhenius's. He was like the first ever definition of acids and bases. And everybody believed that. We're like, we're not worthy. We're not worthy. But then two completely different people in two completely different parts of the world, my boy Johannes Bronsted and Thomas Lowry, they do some experimentation and they look at this compound that's called NH3. Anybody remember nitrogen trihydride slang name?
Ammonia.
Ammonia. Ammonium is NH4 plus. Okay. I misheard. I'm sorry. Right? Ammonia, because of its trigonal pyramidal shape and its lone pair on top, ammonia acted like a base. Even though it doesn't give OHs, it acted like a base. It protected water and it kept water from taking that H plus and no longer being water and becoming this thing called H3O plus. What's H3O plus called? That's called?
Hydronium.
So Bronsted and Lowry noticed that, oh my God, this NH3 protects water. So acids, yeah, okay, acids, yeah, okay. We see you. Okay, son. We see you, son. We see Arrhenius, we agree with your acid definition, but it's not do you give H's and do you give OH's, it's do you give H's or do you nice, or accept H's. And the age of Bronsted-Lowry acids, bases, conjugate acid-base pair, all that fun stuff is born. All right, so believe it or not, I do still have like a half a board, three quarters of a board left to do. If you want to bounce and you just can't take it anymore, you're welcome to leave. I'm going to just rip through how to do pHs real quick, what buffers are, and then titration curves. All right, so if you can hang in there and you want to hang in there a little bit longer, that would be great. If you're like over it, it is a little bit, it's almost 8 o'clock, you're over it and you want to just bounce, no harm, and no feelings hurt, none of that fun stuff, feel free to do you. And I'm going to do a little bit more if you can stomach it. You can actually stomach it. All right, I'll try to make it very simple.
Yeah,
really kind of any of these would work, but there you go. That one will definitely work. Tim Cook does. Cool, baby.
Oh, this? A strawberry acai refresher with no strawberries?
Part of
Was there an ice table on the final create response?
I don't remember.
You don't remember? Okay. I was just seeing.
Yeah.
Sorry.
It's all good, then.
Like always. Like no matter what.
No matter what.
Do you see the thing in your mind?
I'm gonna pass you if you're doing 30 and 45.
I told you, my thing is broken.
My
Mine's broken too. I just know what speed it is broken at.
I did.
All right, ready or not? Baby, baby.
Is that that stupid song? The cowboy song or whatever?
All right. Coming down the home stretch here, ladies and gentlemen. Here we go. Here we go. Here we go. Let's go. Okay, so with acids and bases, right, we know that this thing called hydronium really is different. Water goes from bent to a trigonal pyramidal shape, gets all cray with it. So a way that we have to be able to work with it and measure it, because we have to be able to measure everything in science, is we have the pH scale. P stands for potential. So remember, really, P stands for potential, which really stands for negative log, right? So if I say pH, it's negative log of H. POH would be the negative log of OH. PKA is negative log of KA, right? So when it comes to this idea of pH, really it's as simple as negative log of the concentration of H, or sometimes you'll see it as the negative log of the concentration of hydronium as it really is, H3O plus, but it's the same thing, it's synonymous, right? Another way that you might ever have to solve pH is you might have a base that you're actually given, and they might ask you to solve for the pH. So how would I find the pH of a base? What do I do? I don't actually find pH directly. I find POH first, and then what do I do with it? I subtract it from
14,
right? Also remember that with pH, you're always going to give two decimals. Take sig figs, throw them out the window. All right, take sig figs, throw them out the window. The pH scale goes from 0 to 14. 7 is neutral, right? 7 is neutral. Where did that 0 to 14 nonsense come from? It came from what's called the auto-ionization of water. It's the fact that water can actually separate into its constituent ions as well, and that has a KW, and that's liquid water becoming the two ions. And so it is just like that solubility thing we were just looking at. It's all products. There is no liquid water in it. And that KW of water is 1 times 10 to the negative 14, and that's where the 0 to 14 comes in. Right, that's why 7 is neutral, because if I have X and I have X, if I have a perfect balance between hydronium and hydroxide, I would have X equals 1 times 10 to the negative 7, right? And that 1 times 10 to the negative 7, if I take the log of it, what's the log of 1 times 10 to the negative 7? It is
7.
7. There's where your neutral comes from. That's where it comes from. Now, the pH of acids is actually really, really easy. Except it's not really, really easy at all, but it really is, but it's really not, but it really is, but it's really not. pH always is just this. This is really what pH really is. The problem with pH is figuring out what the flip the hydronium is. That's the problem. That's why these problems become such a pain in your tuchus. With a strong acid, what makes a strong acid strong? A strong acid does what? It burns you, it hurts you, it has a low pH. Lies, lies, and lies. Very good. We're not going to fall for those lies. It fully dissociates. It is a strong electrolyte. It is a strong ionic species. It wants to dissolve. You have hydronium, which is arguably an alkali metal, with some kind of conjugate base that is a strong electrolyte, wants to dissolve. So we could build ice tables. You could ice table every goddamn acid-based question you've ever seen. But with strong acids, I went in with 100, all 100 dissociated. So how many HAs do you have left?
Zero.
And that 100 that I lost, that's the X that I gained for H+. That's also the X that I gained for the conjugate base. And so in reality, that 100, whatever the starting molarity was, whatever the starting moles were, the starting moles are the amount of hydronium ions I'm going to have. The starting moles are the amount of conjugate base ions I'm going to have. And so if pH is just the negative log of H, and this is the concentration of H, and the concentration of H was actually the concentration of the acid to begin with. For strong acids, you could really think of the fact that pH is really just the negative log of the acid itself. Because every one that I have is going to dissociate. So the concentration of H is the concentration of HA for strong acids. That's why we don't use it. That's why we could just use straight stoichiometry. There are seven fine different acids. They are the luckiest acids in all the world. They are the strong ones. What's one of the seven? Hit me up.
Hydrochloric acid.
Nice. The fan favorite HCl hydrochloric. What else?
Hydrobromic.
The funnest one of all to say. Hydroiotic. Hydroiotic, right? Hydroiotic acid. What else? Hydrosulfuric acid? No, not hydrosulfuric acid, just sulfuric. Hydrosulfuric acid is H2S. That's a binary. That is weak. All right, there's four of our seven.
Is acetate one?
Nope. Ooh, nitric, Mr. Soluble himself, who likes to dissolve. And last but certainly not least, perchloric, the perchlorate ion. Some people, yeah, one, two, three, four, five, six. That's six. And the other one is not perchloric acid, but chloric acid. Okay? The most popular, the ones that you really got to be comfortable with, are hydrochloric, sulfuric, nitric, and perchloric. Those are the four most popular. Those are the ones that they'll even mention by name, and they expect you to kind of know. Those are all of the acids that do, in fact, completely dissociate. That's what makes them strong. Not that they have low pHs. They have low pHs because the whole damn thing dissociates. So the whole damn thing becomes the hydronium, and so therefore we have a ton of it. They do a lot of damage because of all of that. What makes a weak acid weak?
It doesn't fully dissociate.
Does not fully dissociate, right? Does not fully dissociate. It does not want to really dissociate. It doesn't want to separate. It's actually what we call a weak electrolyte, a weak acid. It likes to stay together. It prefers to be ha, not ha, ah. It likes to be ha, not ha, ah. It doesn't like to be that, right? It likes to be HA. So with that creates a problem. Because when we do build an ice table for this, I don't lose all 100. So I don't have just 100. I don't have just what I started. I have some fraction. I have some minor amount. I have some kind of percent dissociation that's occurred. Another hint that it's going to be a weak acid. Weak acids are the only kinds of acids that have Ka values. They're the only ones that have equilibrium constants. K sub A for acid. Everything would be the same if we're talking about a weak base, but instead of it being a Ka, it is a Kb. The whole problem with weak acids, and this is why they're an issue, and this is why you need you need the ice table, because the concentration of the acid does not equal the concentration of the hydronium like it does for the strong acid. So this is where, if it's just a weak acid, this is where we first started to kind of use the ice table. This is where we would take what you have at equilibrium and plug it into your Ka, which is going to be aqueous times aqueous over aqueous. Unlike a solid dissolving, you do as you ought to. The acid's always dissolved in water. So that's when we would just plug that in, and you end up with X, or the concentration of X, times the concentration of X, times the concentration of HA originally, which, remember, you can 5% rule out that X for the most part. Almost every time, that X is going to be less than 5%, so you could just poo-poo Pikachu it, right? So you end up with Ka equals the concentration of X squared over HA, and if I want to find what X is, and why do I want to find what X is? Because X is the amount of hydronium that's there at equilibrium. That's the whole problem. What's there at equilibrium for the strong acid is just what was there to begin with. At equilibrium, it's a small fraction. So you have X squared over HA equals Ka. You want to solve for X, because if you solve for X, you know how much H there is. And if you know how much H there is, isn't pH just the negative log of H? Mm-hmm. So for weak acids, pH is really the negative log of X. That's the way you could think of it, if you want to just kind of memorize. All right, just the negative log of X. How do I find X? I multiply by HA. So I end up with concentration of X squared equals Ka times your HA. That's what it's always going to end up being for just a weak acid. How do I get rid of the squared?
Take the square root.
Whatever I do to one side, I do to the other. And so X actually is always going to equal the Ka times the concentration of the acid itself and the square root of that. You would use that value of X to find pH. What else could you use that value of X? Why else would you have to do this math if they asked you to calculate what? Not just pH, but
K-A.
P-O-H maybe, if we needed to find X to find K-A for some reason. How about, remember percent dissociation? Percent dissociation? No, I know. It's concentration of X over concentration of HA times 100%. Or if they ask you, what is the concentration of H or conjugate base at equilibrium? For a weak acid, what's in larger concentration? Do you have more HA or more H plus and A minus? What's the larger concentration for a weak acid? Beautiful. Again, that's why we say it does not fully dissociate. The concentration of the acid, the HA, is greater than that of the concentration of the H or the A. The concentration of the acid is greater. It wants to stay together as HA. It does not want to become H and A minus. That's why you need the ice table for weak, not for the strong. That's why you need it for the weak, not for the strong. If you start titrating a weak acid, what does the titration allow you to calculate? Allows you to calculate the actual value for X, for change, for C. And then you would just calculate accordingly. All right, polyprotic acids. Poly owns a cracker. Think I should get off her soon, right? Poly means more than one. Polyprotic, you're going to give us more than one H. What you have to keep in mind about that is the first H. Just like ionization energy. What electron is the easiest to remove? The first, the second, or the third? The first is the easiest to remove. The first H concentration is the most dominant. The first H concentration is the highest. And so luckily for us in this level, believe it or not, we actually cut this off. In college, you'll do all two or all three H's. But all we care about is the first H because that is by far and away the highest concentration. So all we ever care about is the first one. It does dissociate in a stepwise manner. What does that mean? That means if I do have something that's diprotic, like sulfuric acid, like our strong acid, it turns out that actually the first H is strong. The second H is actually very weak. The second H actually does have a Ka value. So all we care about for even the strong acid that's diprotic, sulfuric, we only care about the first H. The first H is strong. It does not donate two at once. It doesn't just shoot off both at once like a normal ionic species does, right? It does it in a stepwise manner. Okay? With that, we have this idea of conjugate acid-base pairs and all that other fun stuff. And we have this idea of amphibians, aka amphoteric. What does it mean to be amphoteric? If you're amphoteric, you can act as
an acid or a base.
Nice, both an acid and a base. So depending on who and what you are, this is a chameleon. Now again, to a point, we all do this. We all act a little bit different in front of everybody here than we do at home, than we do with our other homies. But for the most part, these things are going to modify themselves depending on who they're with or who they're around. Okay? So for instance, if we look at these two reactions, water, for instance, is an awesome amphoteric species. In the first one, what's water acting as? In the first one, water is actually acting as a base, all about that base, about that base, about that base. How'd you know water's acting as a base? Goes in as H2O and it comes out as what? Comes out as H3O plus. So water accepted an H to become H3O plus. Wait a minute. That means H2O and H3O plus are related. What do we call that? What your acid becomes or what your base becomes, we call that a
conjugate.
This is a conjugate acid base pair. This is a base with its conjugate what? This is a base with its conjugate acid. If we say that water is a weak conjugate, or water is a weak base, right? Water is a weak base, that is going to be a
strong
conjugate acid. If it was a strong base, that would be a
weak
conjugate acid, okay? Why is HA acting as the acid in this situation? HA is acting like the acid because it went in with an H, and what does it come out with? It comes out missing that H. So if you donate an H, you are an acid. So what do we call the A minus that's left behind? We call that the
conjugate
base, right? That's my CB. If this was a weak acid, what kind of conjugate base is that? That is a
strong
conjugate base, seeing that. So water in this case is acting as the base with an acid. What's going on in the second one? What's water actually acting like in the second one? Water is actually acting like the acid. It went in as HOH, and it came out as OH. So it lost its H. That, too, would be a conjugate acid-base pair. This is an acid. This is its conjugate base. This was a weak acid. So what kind of conjugate base is that? Strong, baby. What's NH3 acting like? NH3, that's the thing Bronsted and Lowry both co-discovered at like the same time. NH3 is actually acting as the base. And so NH4, when N is NH3, it accepted an H to become NH4. So NH4 is the conjugate acid. Ammonia is a weak base. Everything except for hydroxide is a weak base. Everything except for an hydroxide compound is a weak base. So if that's a weak base, what kind of conjugate acid is ammonium?
Strong.
Ammonium is a strong conjugate acid. So we would say that water is amphoteric. We say that water is amphoteric because in one reaction, water is acting like a weak base. In the other reaction, water is acting like a weak acid. Okay? Going back to the idea of amphoteric real quick, this conjugate base of a polyprotic, right? It was H2SO4, it gives up one. Here's my A minus, here's my H plus and my A minus. That is a conjugate base in this situation. But if I take that and stepwise dissociate it a second time, is HSO4 acting like a base here?
No.
No, it's actually also acting like an acid. So conjugates from polyprotics, they too are amphoteric. All right, they too are amphoteric. All right, here we go, last push. Buffers. Buffers are a weak acid and a base and its conjugate. So it's a weak acid and its conjugate base, or it's a weak base and its conjugate acid. Okay, you could actually create them yourself by mixing two together like what you did in lab, or you could create them when you titrate, right? Why do we call them buffers? What are they able to do? They are able to large changes in pH. They do still change. They do actually change pH. It's a kind of like an urban myth. Oh, they don't change at all. No. They do still change, but they don't take huge, large changes. If I add an acid to my buffer, what part of the buffer activates? What part of the buffer negates that? What part of the buffer goes, aha, buffer here, you will not touch water? What part of the buffer jumps up? If I add an acid to the buffer, what part of the buffer is going to counteract that? The base, whether it's the original base, or whether it's the conjugate base, we don't care, but it's the base portion of the buffer. If it's a weak acid and it's conjugate, well, then it would have been the conjugate base. If it was a base-base buffer and it's conjugate, well, then it would have been the base part of the base-base buffer. Feeling that?
Mm-hmm.
What if I throw a base? What if I add a base to my buffer? Well, if I add a base to the buffer, what part of the buffer activates and protects water? The acid part of the buffer, or the
conjugate acid,
depending on the creation of the buffer, depending on it. What do we call the most effective buffer in all of the land is what we call an
ideal buffer.
Nice. Equals an ideal buffer. What is an ideal buffer? When the concentration of the HA and the concentration of the conjugate base, what, are equal to, greater than?
Equal.
Very nice. Equal to each other. We want the concentration of the acid and its conjugate base to be equal. The higher those concentrations, the higher my buffer capacity. The more I can hold before you break me. The lower these concentrations, the lower my buffer capacity, the quicker I break before, or the quicker I change and I break. What is that formula we use for buffers? David Hasselhoff's long-lost cousin, Henderson Hasselbalch. pH equals pKa plus the log of the conjugate acid, or the conjugate, over the original. Remember, they give that to you on the reference sheet. But at the ideal buffer, anybody remember on a titration curve, where do we create the ideal buffer? At the
buffer zone.
Ooh, somebody got it. Half EP, the half equivalence point. At the half equivalence point, concentration of A and HA equal each other. That's one. What's the log of one?
Zero.
So at the half equivalence point, or at the ideal buffer spot, pH equals pKa.
pH equals pKa. Titration. Titration is the process of, in a quantified manner, in a controlled quantified manner, adding a known volume of a known concentration to an unknown volume and an unknown concentration. Right? What do we always do? When you deal with concentrations, you're going to multiply. You're going to end up always multiplying the liters of titrant times what? We don't want liters. We want to get it into moles. So you take the liters that you added and multiply it by what? You multiply it by the molarity of the titrant. And what that's going to give me is the moles of titrant added. Because at the end point, the moles added equals what? The moles added equals the?
Moles.
Oh, I like that. I should have used that word. Original. Original moles. Original moles or started moles. Okay? If it is like HA plus H2O yields H3O. If it is like one of these, that's a 1:1:1 ratio. What's that magical little formula, ladies and gentlemen? That magical little formula, if 1:1 ratio. In the reaction, we can use, nice, M1, hello. M1V1 equals M2V2. Usually your M1, this is usually what you're solving for. This is usually your sample. Your M and V1 are usually your sample. And your M2V2 is your titrate, what you actually added, usually. Doesn't have to be. Okay? If it's a 1:1, you could just use M1V1 equals M2V2. Right? So, for instance, if I had HA, some unknown weak acid, and I added some known strong base to it, remember, as you ever do every little drip head, you are forcing this sucker to completion. So you're forcing this thing to act like a full, complete, strong acid. What kind of, well, we'll do the pH on the picture. We'll do the pHs on the picture. So if I told you you added 25 milliliters, 25.0 milliliters of 3.5 molar NaOH, and you added that to a 10.0 milliliter sample of HA originally, what's the molarity of HA? Is it a 1:1 ratio?
No.
In my balanced chemical reaction, 1:1?
Yeah.
Yeah, buddy. So since it's 1:1, I'm going to use M1V1 equals M2V2. They're asking me to solve for the molarity of the HA. So M1 equals, how do I get M1 all alone? What do I do with the V1? Divide it out. So M1 equals M2 times V2 over V1. With M1, V1 equals M2, V2, do you have to put the volume in liters?
No.
Nice. It's like PVT equals P2, V2, T2, right? So I could actually leave this as the 3.5 molar times the 25.0 milliliters, divide by the 10.0 milliliters you had originally, and that would tell you your molarity that you had of your original sample. If I had a 0.50 molar solution of strong acid, and I had a 0.50 molar solution of weak acid, which one would require more base to neutralize?
The strong acid.
This was the question that almost
everybody
got.
Oh my God, it's the same because of the volumes. Oh my God.
Remember, it's always about those moles. So if I have equal volumes of equal molarity of acids, equal amount, equal moles or equal amount of NaOH to neutralize. All right, here we go, guys. It's almost here. We're almost here. Oh my God, we're almost here. All right, what's my first one? Oh, I could feel it. I'm getting excited. Oh my God, here we go. What's my first one? This first top left one. What am I titrating with what? What do I have in my sample? I have a
weak acid
being titrated by
a strong base.
Strong base, baby. How'd you know it's weak acid by strong
there's
base? Talk to me. Talk to me, baby. Use a percentile. What?
Oh my God.
You started with like 3. That's a pH of like 3. It's not super weak or super strong. Oh yeah, we get that little curvature, right? The buffering region. Remember, from this moment to this moment, this is what we call the buffering region. Now, wait a minute. I thought in order to create a buffer, you had to have the weak acid with its conjugate. Exactly. Every little drip drip, every little drip of NaOH I throw in there, I'm forcing this acid to dissociate.
I'm eating up those H pluses. So the H plus disappears from our ice table because every little drip drip eats up the H plus. But wait a minute. What did we just say? If I take away a product, which way does it shift? It shifts to the right. So as you titrate a weak acid, you create more and more conjugate base and you create that buffer region. All right, this moment right here where the slope is like infinite. What do we call that? That is the equivalence point. Very good. That's equivalence point, not end point. End point is when the indicator changes color. The end point should be close to equivalence point, but it's not the same. What's the equivalence point going to be here? Is it going to be equal to 7 or greater than 7?
Greater
than 7. Remember, for weak acid by strong base, pH is about like 8.2. And that's because all we have is water and we have that conjugate base. But what kind of conjugate base was that? That was the conjugate base from what kind of an acid? Boom. Give me my freaking points. I want some. I need some. I love it.
Question? No. Okay. I'm saying thanks. Hello. All right.
If this is 30 and that's my equivalence point, what is 15 milliliters? If that was 30 milliliters, 15 is my half equivalence point. And what did we just say over here? At the half equivalence point, what's so special at the half equivalence point? You have just created what kind of a buffer? You've created
an
ideal buffer. Before the half equivalence point, this whole area here before the half equivalence point, I have more acid than I do conjugate base. At the half equivalence point, acid and base are the same. That's why it's ideal. What do you got going on after the half equivalence point? Who's got the greater concentration after the half equivalence point? I now have more conjugate base than I do acid. As we take off, I've used up all the acid. So the only stuff you really have left beyond even the equivalence point is all hydroxide plus water plus conjugate base. But the hydroxide takes over because it is the strongest of all. All right, how are we feeling about that? What's the one below it?
Strong acid with a strong base.
Strong acid titrated by a strong base. How do we know that?
Because it's just straight up. There's no buffer zone.
Starting real low. We don't have a buffer. Now, why does it still take a while to get going? Because a strong acid, what do you have predominantly in concentration in a strong acid? You have a ton of
H pluses.
So those H pluses are just sitting there waiting to be eaten up. It's not going to jump up and then level off. It's just going to steadily increase. So as you get going, again, you're going to go and go and go. This part right here, infinite slope, we call that the equivalence point or the EP. What's the pH of a strong on strong? The pH of a strong on strong is
7.00.
The reason why it's 7.00 is because, again, all I have is water and conjugate base like I do up here. But what kind of conjugate base is it this time? That is a very weak conjugate base. All right, that's a very weak conjugate base. All right, last two. Here we go, guys. Here we go. This is it. What do I got going on with the getting down over here?
Weak base with a strong acid.
Nice. This is a weak base that I'm titrating by a strong acid. This to this would be my buffer zone this time. Right? That's my buffer zone. This is my equivalence point. What's the equivalence point pH going to be?
Less than seven,
somewhere around 6, probably like 5.8 or something like that. Everything but opposite. Now I have water and not conjugate base, but now I got water and conjugate acid, as they call it, pH plus, the base with the extra H plus. If this was 30 and this was my equivalence point, what's 15? 15 is my half equivalence point. What we say so special about half equivalence point?
It's an ideal buffer.
All right, that's the ideal buffer. Right. Before the half equivalence point, you have more base than you do conjugate acid. At the half equivalence point, what makes it ideal? You have
equal
concentration to conjugate acid. Yeah. And after, you have more conjugate acid than you do base, and that's why the pH starts to drop off. Once you blow past the end point, you have prominently H plus in solution. You also have water, and you also have conjugate acid. But the H plus is the strongest, most dominant species. Last but not least is the strong base by strong acid with a pH. The equivalence point pH is going to be 7.00 because, yet again, I have water and conjugate acid but that conjugate acid is a weak conjugate acid, so it does not affect the pH at all. All right?
Wait, isn't it
weak?
Where?
This one?
Yeah.
No, that was the weak one up here. That's why we had the buffering region.
Yeah, no, it's all good. Great question. All right, last thing to just remember is the idea that you have indicators, right? Indicators change when you have those different pH ranges. They change the different colors. You want to pick them accordingly. You want to pick them closest to your pH. And when you pick an ideal buffer, when you pick an ideal buffer, you want to pick the ideal buffer whose acid's Ka, its pKa, is close to the pH that you're looking for. All right? It's a lot. Like, holy freaking cow. Talk about, 2 hours and 35 seconds shorter than I thought it was going to be. Mad props to you. Mad props to you guys for hanging in there. Yes, sir.
No hash to lose strong.
Technically, you do have one, but there's just nothing special about it. With the weak, because it creates that buffer, that's why it's so special. So again, thank you so much, guys, for coming. Thank you so much for hanging in there. As the shirt says, legit, just relax. At this point, you either know it or you don't. Doesn't mean don't keep studying, but listen, you're going to not know everything, and that's okay. My morning crew peeps that are here today, tomorrow we do meet. Tomorrow is a shortened day. But I'm not, like, if those of you that want to work, we'll kind of just go off in the corner and we'll keep working. You have AP class. If you have AP tests coming Monday, Tuesday, or Wednesday, I almost suggest that maybe you bring your stuff tomorrow morning and just worry about that for 50 minutes than this. But if you want to work with this stuff, I'm going to still go. But I also will let you kind of go off in the corner, put earbuds in, and study your other stuff if you want. All right, thank you so much. Be careful driving home. Horizontal trees are dear. Be careful. Okay, horizontal trees are dear.
Wait, what's the last one? Weak case by weak acid.
It's a strong base because I started real high.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it has to be base there.
Oh, okay.
Okay, and because I don't have any kind of like curvature, I don't have any like buffering region. It's a slow burn. Just like that's a slow burn. That's how I know it's a strong base, not just a weak base. Because if it was a weak base, it would have buffered.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Right,
yeah.
Yeah. Good question. Yeah. Cool.
I figured out the